This episode deals with the inappropriateness of racial invectives and contains coarse racial slurs. Viewer discretion is advised.
Everybody loves Donner Bike.
And yes, the rumors are true. They smoke, they drink, they use bad language in mixed company. They're extremely rich and they can flash more bling than most posses in this room. Rock stars they are, and God bless them for that.
You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe.
Second lip on the end there.
Yeah.
We would have had to snip the lip. So, in other words, your pregnant pause was on purpose.
Yeah, yeah. I actually did it because I wanted you guys to be tighter.
Yeah, Bill O'Reilly, thought of the day.
Yes.
Got it for you. Bill, what's your thought today? What say you?
I'm sorry I raped that lady.
There's the Bill. Bill O'Reilly.
Well, I'm sorry.
Thought of the day. Every day Bill comes to us with some pearl of wisdom, and today Billy O'Reilly says,
I'm sorry I raped that lady.
Jeez.
There he is.
Wow.
Bill
He's
O'Reilly.
Just lapping Dr. Phil. He truly is.
You know,
it's the best bit we ever stole.
As you go through the day, and you need to pick me up.
I'm sorry I raped that lady.
Oh, my God.
Think about good old Bill O'Reilly.
Wow.
Okay, Robbie, you need that pirate music. And while you're working on the pirate music, I'll tell you why we need that in just a moment.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, you have, in fact, flooded the server at WJFK.com.
Did they break it?
Nope, they did not break it.
Good.
Everybody at the G3 group, that is the computer company, have done a marvelous job for us with this
marvelous
with this website.
Good.
We have over 40,000 votes thus far.
All right.
And I will tell you that there are two people that are miles in front of the rest.
Miles and miles.
It is a horse race, if you will. It is a horse race. One of these people has 10,160 votes. The second place person has 9,990 votes.
Who is it?
Wouldn't you like to know?
Oh! Yes, yes, he
wouldn't you like to know? I will tell you, but I won't tell you which is which.
Oh. So you won't tell me who the leader is?
No. But the two people who are in the lead are, in no particular order, Janet and Dave.
Uh-huh.
Janet and Dave.
Do we remember what they sang?
I got no idea.
Me neither.
I don't. I think
congratulations to both of them, though.
Dave is the guy who sang the rose. Now, the voting is not closed. We'll leave this website up throughout today's show.
By the end of the show, will we have a winner?
Yes. I think in segment number six today, we will announce the winner of the show.
Segment number six.
And, she sang When the Saints Go Marching In, Mike.
Oh, wonderful.
I don't know, at home, you're wondering how are the segments planned today. Well, look at this. Today, it's on red paper.
You know, that's just beautiful. It's almost Christmassy.
Isn't that nice? Red,
almost pinkish.
All them different colors and junk on there.
It matches your logo a little
bit.
There
you go, right there. Yes, and you would never know that this piece of Nike merchandise was a second, would you?
Never.
You would not know that there's something.
A million years.
I'm staring at this baby and wondering, you know, the one that I had on yesterday, the sweatshirt I had on yesterday, had, or on Monday, had the sleeves that went way over my hands.
Yeah, too long.
And then yesterday I had that awful bright pumpkin orange.
You look like you could run up the Rocky Steps right now in Philadelphia.
But I have no idea what's wrong with it's a sweatpants and sweatshirt that I have on today.
With the runaway success of 8 Mile, does the hood fit over your headphones?
Well, there you go. See it, Robbie.
I'm sure it does.
Yo, yo.
Of course it does.
Now that's a good look.
That is a look.
Up in here, up in here.
There you go. I like it.
I'm down with that. So anyway.
It's getting hot in here, so take off all your clothes.
Vote early and vote often. Go to WJFK.com to vote for your favorite American idiot. Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Hey, Don.
Yeah, hi.
I love the Bill O'Reilly minute, and now I listen to Bill O'Reilly just to see if I could pick out what you're going to snag.
Yeah, you know,
so it works.
Yeah.
Hey, you know what? Isolate that, save it, put it on a tape cartridge.
We don't chop his words up to make him say stuff that he didn't actually say on his show.
But it's very important to point out that this caller has just said he listens.
It's like an ongoing game. I get to play it every day.
Yeah. Good game.
What will the Bill O'Reilly moment be? What will the thought of the day be?
I'm sorry I raped that lady.
That's his thought today.
We are, in fact, recycling our listeners into the Bill O'Reilly Show.
Hello, really. Don and Mike Show. Hello.
Hello.
Hi, you're on the air.
Don, you got to get out that night and you got to get with Adidas.
No, no, I will never be an Adidas man. I'm a Nike man until the day I die, sir. You know what Adidas is? That's a flash of the pan. Or as my mom used to call them when I was a kid, Adidas.
Adidas. Hasn't the Adidas company been around longer than Nike?
Well, technically, yes. But they're a flash in the pan, Mike.
What about Puma?
I think they've been around longer than Nike as well.
Or Puma, as Tommy Smothers used to say.
Run DMC never did a song about Nike.
Yeah,
Adidas.
Or Reebok.
Okay.
Listen. Now, Reebok's been around after Nike, right?
I am loyal to Nike.
Yes.
I'm a Nike man all the way, and it has gotten me absolutely dick, except one time.
I'm a Men's Warehouse kind of fella.
One time, like 5 years ago, they did send us a couple of sweatshirts, didn't they, the Nike company?
Yeah, I think I might have given mine to you.
Well, no, you didn't give it to me because I remember the one that they gave to me. I don't wear it. It's a Dallas Cowboys sweatshirt.
Oh.
Like, the only team that I don't wear merchandise from is the Dallas Cowboys.
That's a good thing. Send us merchandise.
Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Don and Mike.
Send us gifts.
Presents.
Hello, presents.
Presents for everyone.
We like presents. Hi, Don and Mike Show.
Hi, Don and Mike.
Yeah.
Hi, Tucker Todd here, Sacramento.
Hi there.
I just wanted to call and tell you guys that you make my day every day. Every afternoon in this little miserable hell I call my truck.
All right.
For 4 hours every afternoon, you guys make my day.
Keep an ear out for Smokey. Thank you for calling.
thing, guys.
All right. See you later. What, Mike?
I was just waiting for the other shoe to drop.
Oh, no, that was a good caller from Sacramento.
Yeah, if you'd kept him longer, he would have asked for something.
Hello, Don and Mike show.
You guys, man, you guys are terrible. You guys are a disgrace to radio.
Yeah. And you're an upstanding, award-winning citizen.
When are they going to take you guys off?
You're one of God's most favorite creatures.
Tell them we went Don and Mike back.
Yeah, we'll tell them.
That is good. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Yeah, man, I just wanted to call and ask Mike if he would do a Schwarzenegger impersonation.
I just want to say, power, we feel that the Rainbow Coalition will get people together.
Arnold, what?
That is his Arnold Schwarzenegger impression.
You hear my Jesse Jackson?
Perfect. Yeah, let's hear that.
I don't have a tumor.
Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hey, Don, your mom was actually correct. Adidas was started by a German gentleman named Adi Daslos. So calling him Adi Das is actually the right way to...
Wow. Right. Man, I love our listening audience.
That's all right, terrific. Thank you.
He's German, Rob.
My mom was just being dumb back in the day when she would say, I went to the store, but those Adi Das, they cost so much.
Yes.
Why can't you just wear Keds?
Yes.
No, Keds were always baggy, I thought. Back in the day...
I wore Purcells.
I liked Chuck Panthers, high-top Chucks.
I think I wore, is it Bill Purcells? Whatever the tennis sneakers with the blue stripe in front of them?
You wore those?
Yeah, I played tennis. I was on the tennis team.
Well, that would explain. You wore Purcells while you played tennis.
Yeah, I mean, you go back and look like an early tennis shoe, like the one I wore. In tennis shoes, as far as tennis shoe technology, you go back even like to the early 70s and look at a tennis shoe, and it looks like something that like Rickenbacker wore in the biplanes in World War One.
I wore Pony.
Pony.
Yeah. When I was a child, I wore a Rockport.
Rockport Juniors.
There was a time when Pony was the up and comer.
Yeah, yeah.
There's always been pretenders to the throne, mm-hmm. but for my money, and I, God knows I spend tons of it on it, you can't beat Nike, even though I know.
What about the footwear? Specifically the footwear. I mean, you're wearing the Nike clothing. Right?
Always Nike shoes. Always.
Nike shoes?
Always. Do you even know my dress shoes? My wife bought me a pair of grown-up shoes
right.
at Cole Haan.
Yeah, yeah. Cole Haan was merged with Nike.
Yeah, and she said, when I got them for Christmas last year.
My friend at the shoe store said, they've ruined the shoes. They've ruined the shoes. Why do they make this? Cole Haan, a fine shoemaker, and they turn into a sneaker now.
Yeah, when I went through on Christmas, I opened up the box, and I see that it's a pair of hard shoes. And, I'm disappointed, but I'm faking it with my wife. He said, oh, these are... These are real nice shoes. Like, I don't want hard shoes for Christmas.
And are they those hard shoes that have the little cushion in the heel?
Yeah, and she said, turn it over and look at the other side. And I looked on the bottom by the heel and by where the ball of your foot is, and there's the Nike swish. They're like Nike dress shoes.
I'm a big fan of the Nike golf wear. I think Nike makes a mean golf shirt.
Love Nike, even though I know, and don't even bother calling or faxing or emailing. I know.
Doing just to get the suitcases here.
I know they're all of them, Nike, Adidas, Reebok. I know they're all made by kids in sweatshops mm-hmm. over in third world countries who make mm-hmm. 2 cents a day. I know that.
Yeah.
I realize that the shoes that I pay $50 for, some kid put it together and he makes like a penny a day.
How do you think they get that Nike logo to go right in the middle of that shirt?
Well, and that's the thing. That's something I was wondering about when I was listening to this.
You figure when you're buying an irregular that it might be a little cockeyed?
A little off-center?
Or cook-eyed?
Yeah. A little off-center? Nah, it's perfect. Listen, everybody right now, you got the pirate music, Rob?
I got the best I can do.
Okay, very important. I am the pop, the, is this Popeye?
No, it's the theme from Sea
Hunt. The theme from Sea Hunt. All right, well, listen, here's why I wanted pirate-like music. We have a contest today, but only somebody who can show up at the radio station can win the contest.
Very good.
We have a trip to Las Vegas to give away to see the Ultimate Fighting Championship. Great trip out to Vegas, including round-trip air, hotel, and tickets to the event.
Do you want pirate music?
Yes, and I'll tell you why I wanted pirate music. This is not pirate music, but it's the closest we can find.
Right.
We're going to have a scavenger hunt.
Oh, cool.
Goody, come there. Now, follow my lead here, guys. We have Don, Mike, Buzz, right. Rob A., and Lisa. Each of us will come up with an item, an offbeat, quirky item, but not impossible, for someone to find and bring to the radio station by the end of the show. I will start by saying that my item in the scavenger hunt is a 46 double D bra. My item in the scavenger hunt is a 46 double D bra. That's what you'll need for my part to win in the scavenger hunt. You guys need more time to think about this?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, I want to make sure. Is this an item that could be purchased?
Yeah, I mean, it should actually be, and it was just the first thing that I thought of that you could buy or you might have around the house. So it's right. So that they're easy enough that a lot of people could participate in the contest, and it's really a race.
Mm-hmm. All right. I've got mine.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
I would like a bottle of Plaques Mint mouthwash in the largest size possible.
Okay. There you go. That's in the spirit of the scavenger hunt.
And it's saving me a trip to the drugstore.
Let's go to Robbie Speedbump.
Okay, I'll say a 45 RPM record.
Very good.
Wow, those are not easy to come by.
No, they're not.
Buzz Girdley.
I would like a single regular red construction brick. Just a brick, like you'd build a house with, a brick.
That's good. That's a good brick. One, Buzz. That's a good one. And
mine's the worst, isn't it?
Finally, Lele. No, it's not. Lele.
Thank you.
No, this will be. A green shag bathroom carpet. A little area carpet.
All right. So,
yes, it has to be green.
Wow, that might be the toughest item of all to come up with.
No, not if you go to Bed Bath & Beyond.
let's review now. With Lisa Herndon. Lisa, in today's scavenger hunt... Oh, what is this now? Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea?
Yeah.
In today's scavenger hunt, be the first to show up...
Hasn't started yet, really.
Here at the Don and Mike World Headquarters, WJFK Radio, Main Street in Fairfax, Virginia, with these five items, and you will win a trip to Las Vegas. Lisa, the items are...
A 46 double D bra, a bottle of Mint Plaques, in the largest size possible. This is very important. The largest size they make.
Thank you.
A 45 RPM record, a single red brick that they would use in construction, a single brick, and a green shag bathroom area rug.
Shag.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So that's shag, baby.
Yeah, shag, baby.
So,
yeah, baby.
So that's it. You know, because it has to be a local winner. They have to fly out of Dulles or something like that.
Now,
is
that going to be it, or do you want to like go around the horn again?
No. That's it. I think the show's now been on 18 minutes. We're going to be on for like 3.5 more hours.
Yeah.
It's going to be plenty hard for people to find those five items.
Yeah.
And bring them here to the station. But hurry, everybody, because the first person here with all five items wins a trip to Las Vegas to see the Ultimate Fighting Championship 40, the Vendetta match, and you can stay at the MGM Grand out in Las Vegas.
Man, that is a great trip, and I love these trips to Las Vegas we've been giving away.
It's a beautiful city. It's a beautiful time. Well, hell, it's always a beautiful time in Las Vegas because you never go outside. You always stay inside. There's no clocks in Las Vegas.
You go from man-made environment to man-made environment.
Hello, Don and Mike show. Hello there.
Hi.
Hi.
My name is Eric. I live in Napa.
How are you, Eric?
San Francisco. Hi.
Yeah, and, you know, since I started listening to the San Francisco feed instead of the Sacramento feed,
yeah,
I can feel IQ points coming back.
That is, and he lives in a beautiful, and you know, I have never, ever considered anyone that calls from Napa to be a Sacramento caller. I really think
you're a Bay Area caller.
Yeah. And you know, even though you're not really officially in the Bay Area either, you're in that beautiful wine country where Rudy Martsky has a cot.
Yeah. And I imagine just listening to us on the San Francisco station as opposed to the Sacramento station makes you feel better about yourself, doesn't it?
Right, but they need to do a little bit of work in their advertising department because I think they only have like five commercials.
Oh, on the San Francisco station?
Yeah. So well, let's give San Francisco some help out there.
Absolutely. Well, you know, it's a beautiful city, and, you know, your part of the world is beautiful country. I love it out there.
Thank you, my friend. Feel better about yourself.
Yeah.
Listen to the San Francisco station.
And, of course, let's not discount Sacramento, where the fog settles in over the tomato plant.
Hello, Mike. So, hello. We love Sacramento.
We do. I love it out there.
Hey, guys.
They're just the unofficial punching bag of the show.
You know, you have to have someone. We, you know, when you're syndicated in this many cities, you have to have one city that you poke a little fun at.
Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hey, guys. Great show. Great contest.
Oh, thanks.
Why does it sound like you guys are decorating your houses, though?
Well,
with a bra?
Yeah.
Hold on. You couldn't think of a scotch you wanted?
A what?
A scotch? No, actually, you're a vodka drinker, aren't you?
Booze? No, seriously. The thought was you come up with offbeat items.
Yeah.
I thought this was part of the trend of you guys getting free stuff again.
And I will admit, unlike anybody, and I'm going to bust myself here, okay, because it came up very suddenly, and because I am just in an incredibly selfish state of mind lately, I really,
you want
lazily,
for yourself.
Lazily, I have gone 3 days where I've had to, I have my routine, where I take a slam of that plaque, spit it out, floss my teeth, take another slam, and brush my teeth, and I haven't had my plaque, so I've had to do it with water, and it's just not adequate at all. I've had toothpaste, of course.
Poor Mike.
So I just, I haven't been able
to. Poor Mike.
I'm as guilty as Mike.
Poor me, yeah, I know.
I love my records.
And I need a brick.
You decided not to go with, hey, pick up my dry cleaning?
You know, if Don did the scavenger hunt yesterday.
Hello, Don and Mike should be the first to pick up Mike's dry cleaning. Hello, Don and Mike.
Where's your class of death tonight?
JB? I don't know how you let that guy through.
I can't believe that, Joe Billy.
Is that his new name, Joe Billy?
No, we found out that's his middle name.
I call him JB, I call him
JB.
Joe Billy.
Hey, JB.
Did he do the crap detector thing?
Yeah.
Damn, I got him earlier.
Come on, Joe Billy.
Same guy. Come on, JB. You got to get with it.
Got to tighten it up.
JB Ardinger.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Big mistake before the show today when Joe let slip his middle name as William.
All right.
Right away, it was JB and Joe Billy.
Joe Billy and JB.
I think it gives him a more worldly appeal. And when I hear the name, I think of the little Monopoly man, you know.
Right, right.
This is J.B. Ardinger.
And, of course, the name I gave him, you know, means that he's right out of, Mayberry.
Right.
With Ernest T. Bass. Joe Billy Ardinger.
J.B. Ardinger here. Hello, Don and Mike show.
What's up, fellas?
Hey.
I'm calling from Sacramento, and
What?
Sacramento. What am I calling? Who is this?
Nah, all you're right. Faking it.
Hello, Don and Mike show. You're too funny to really be from Sacramento. Hello, Don and Mike.
We also have good buffets out here, boys.
This is the blind guy?
You betcha.
How are you? Hey, blind guy, how are you?
How y'all doing?
How's it going today? You have a good buffet?
I didn't go today.
You did go? Okay.
We love our blind listeners because to our blind listeners, we're television stars and we're movie stars.
And this is my favorite.
All rolled up into one.
This is my favorite blind guy because he's got such a unique sounding voice. He kind of has that voice. Well, I do declare.
Now,
you declare.
At a buffet, do you use Braille or do you go by the aromas?
Or do you put your hands in the food?
I go by the aromas.
Uh-huh.
The aromas.
The buffets are the better.
Now, you've been blind since birth, right?
Let me check. Yeah.
All right. I'm going somewhere with this. Do you know what a woman's breast looks like?
You already asked me that a long time ago.
Well, I don't remember the answer.
The answer was no.
No, you don't.
What they feel like.
What do you think they look like based on your feeling of them?
They just feel good.
Well, no. I mean, but what shape are
they? I'll explain it to you.
Yeah, what shape are they?
Some are round.
Some are round. You've run into some that aren't round?
That is the cruelest. In your own little way, that is the cruelest thing you do. It's like, he's blind since birth. Yeah, but tell me what they look like.
Well, I would like...
What do you want him to do?
I'm not being cruel. I'm trying to find out. I want to help him here.
If he was to read a book, and I'm sure he has, that describes a woman's breast... That would suffice. I mean, have you read like saucy romance novels ever?
Yeah, a fucking book.
And I bet that they describe in pretty
of everything from getting it on from the time they start to do it till the end.
But I understand where Don's coming from, where since it's congenital.
I wasn't busting this guy's balls.
I was wondering when you do that.
Since he's only felt them.
I just can't explain it to you.
Can you visualize them in your head based on what you felt?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, cool.
Mm. Yeah.
It's
like a,
was that you?
No, that was not me. It sounded like me.
Yeah.
Our best breakfast buffet out here is our champagne brunches.
What, now, where's your favorite champagne brunch?
Boulder Station.
Now, they ought to give you a free one after that.
There you go, my friend. All right. Well, good luck. Thanks for listening.
Well, I listen every day.
Okay.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Y'all be good now.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Friend.
Bye-bye.
You've always had, you know, since I've known you, a unique relationship with the blind.
I do love blind guys.
You do. And I love blind guys listening to this show.
Hello, Don and Mike show.
You love the afflicted.
Hello.
Hi, you're on the air.
Hi, this is Cliff. I'm in Las Vegas.
Hi, Cliff.
The best buffet is at the Golden Nugget.
Well, he was talking about Sacramento, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
But the
you got a Palace Station up there. We got them out here. We got a.
Can you imagine? Station. That's like you played the lottery and God has crapped on you twice. You're blind and you live in Sacramento.
Mm, I know.
Yeah, but if he's got to go to a Palace Station, you know, he doesn't know.
But see, maybe being blind in Sacramento is a blessing.
Yeah, Buzz, you know what? You're right because he doesn't know.
Yeah,
he doesn't know. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hello.
You know what we should
I'm
do?
Kidding, of course.
We should do something to. I know that you know the mass plans for sterilization in third world countries and stuff like that. There should be some mass plan to blind everybody in Sacramento. So
thank you for coming over to our team on that.
So that they don't realize where they're living.
Yeah, and because it makes them very angry.
Yeah, it would be
this
less unhappy.
This is perhaps not the best idea you've ever had. It's starting to sound a little. 1938 Berlinish.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Got a touch of that.
Although I like the sentiment.
I know you do.
I just don't like where it could go.
Wow.
Didn't work for us last time.
That's amazing. You know, it's weird to hear you express reason.
Yeah.
Well,
Robin, I wasn't even thinking of your guys.
I know.
I was thinking like in third world countries, the things they do to women in third
but
world countries.
But if you did that, you know, if you did that to everybody in Sacramento, they'd just get angrier.
Yeah.
That's true. Yeah.
And they could still call.
You know what you need to do?
You need to remove their voice boxes.
And cut off their dialing fingers.
But then the basketball team wouldn't be able to play. If all the Kings had no fingers.
Right, and there would not be a lot of produce on our tables.
Yeah.
That's right. God love them. The Sacramento comes up with lots of tomatoes
they
for
do,
us.
Indeed.
The produce stands would just be fingers. Special baskets of fingers.
Don and Mike show. Hello.
Hello. Hi, Mike.
Yeah, you're on the air. Hi there.
Hi, my name's Michelle. I'm calling from Woodbridge.
Hi there, Michelle.
I just finally got through. I've been trying to call for months, so I wanted to say hello.
No, hi.
Hello.
I know the secret sound, but I know it's too early.
Yeah, right. Yeah, you know it. Everybody knows it, honey.
No, I do. Honest to God, I do.
Well, really?
Would you be willing to put anything on the line to prove it?
Like what?
Well, either I'll give you two choices. You come down and you guess.
Okay.
And if you're wrong, you have to take all your clothes off. Or if you're so pushy that you're one of these people, you just can't wait to be caller 100, you could give us your phone number. And then if you guess incorrectly, we broadcast your phone number.
Okay.
Really? Which is it going to be, the nudity or the phone number? Do you find...
I'll have to go for the phone number. My husband won't appreciate the nudity.
All right, hold on a second, honey.
Okay.
Hold on a second.
And that's a deal you don't offer very often.
No. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Don.
Yeah.
F you. That's from Sacramento, man.
Well, why, directed just at me? I'm the last one. I'm the last one to join the party.
You know, get off your high horse there over there in D.C. I mean, for Christ's sake, for the last 2 months you've been bitching about people shooting people, and you got to crap on Sacramento all the time, man. I'm tired of it.
Hey, can I tell you something, sir? You are the reason I wish everyone in Sacramento was blind. Yeah. You're the reason.
I have no comment to that.
I mean, you have no comment to that.
And to the guy who switched to the San Francisco station, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah, I'm going to go from being a cool guy in Sacramento to being a fag.
There you go, being a fag, because everybody in San Francisco is a fag.
This is the whole problem with Sacramento.
Angry.
And I mean this, now I'm not speaking from a comedic standpoint. Now, I swear on the kid's life, I'm speaking honestly. Sacramento is a wonderful city that gives us great ratings. Mm-hmm. We've been there. It's a very livable city.
Yeah.
I've even mentioned to my wife that, and don't let this leave the room, that when it comes time to pack it up, I might even think about living in Sacramento when I get there so much. But the truth of the matter is...
Hold everything. Stop.
I realize I said that. What's wrong with
you?
But the truth of the matter
you
is...
Yeah.
the truth of the matter is,
Rob,
Sacramento is loaded with people who take it way too personally, which is why we love goofing on Sacramento, because then dummies like you call up.
Don, I agree. It's the white trash capital of the world, man. But, There's some people here, and I love how you can say that, and then Rob and Mike are doing the monkey dance out there.
You just said, in a way, you don't like being there, and you're still there. You don't understand. Get out.
Run.
Don't you see?
Blind him now,
there
God.
There are none so blind as those who will not
ever,
see.
Have we ever said, have we ever said on this show that Sacramento is the white trash capital of the world?
Never.
We have never said that.
Never.
It is a different dynamic.
Baltimore is the white trash capital of the world.
Don't you see your problem, sir? In a way, you agree. You don't like Sacramento either.
Robbie, the problem is he just doesn't get it. Yeah. He doesn't get it.
Actually, the thing that I don't like about it is the fact that you lump everybody together in one. You know, you lump us all under that.
It's a joke.
Again, let me just point out again, and this is why.
It's a joke, you incredible.
This is why.
Moron.
This is why Sacramento
Mike, get some treatment for your alcoholism, buddy.
This is why Sacramento.
Listen, hold on. Give me a moment here.
Our punching bag.
Listen to you. Listen to the hatred.
Yeah.
Listen to the fact that you just don't get the joke. You don't sit back and just laugh. And then you go, get some treatment for your alcoholism. Why the anger, sir?
Hello?
I'm here.
Why the anger? Why so angry? Why not just take it for what it is? Meaningless BS.
But, you're talking about where I live, man.
Why the feeling of inadequacy? Why? I ask you that. Answer me that question.
I have no answer for that.
And this is why we will continue to pound Sacramento on this show.
I can answer why he feels inadequate.
Why, Rob?
Oh, well, over and above the lack of intellect, it's because he hasn't enough gumption to leave a land that he hates. Understand, there are 50 other states, and they're all pretty much connected, save for two, and they all speak the same language, and they're all happier than where you live. So get out. There's fast food joints that will employ you.
There are 49 other states.
Well, 50 states total. Yeah. I'm sorry. I'm very emotional because this man troubles me greatly.
He's counting Puerto Rico. We get calls like this from where you live.
We've tried the serious approach. We've tried the comedic approach with you. But the reason that Sacramento is the punching bag of this show is guys like you.
It is not, and I reiterate, and I'm being serious here, it is not all of Sacramento. And we have to say that when we get a dummy like you. It's the individual.
I guess it's just very ironic that, you know, the place that gives you your highest ratings is the one that you hate the most.
Sacramento does not give us our highest ratings. You guys give us great ratings, but we don't have our highest ratings in Sacramento.
And we have been making fun of Sacramento since we have been on. For the majority of the time we've been on, we make fun of Sacramento, and the ratings still stay high. And you know why? Because the majority of people that listen out there that don't call in like dumbasses like you...
They get it.
They get the joke.
They get the joke.
But you don't.
I have no response to that.
Yeah. Well, that's fine.
And there you go.
Please, God, strike him blind. Strike him blind, God, please.
I think that went well.
And all right, really, that is it. And there is no region of the country that has given us more calls like that. Now, that is not a stereotype. It is not a generalization.
Hey, man, why are you always getting down on Sacramento?
Oh, I got no response for that. Duh.
I'll make a generalization. I bet plants prosper. I bet you plants thrive on hate. And that's why things grow so well out.
Hello, here's the lady.
Better than nitrogen.
Here's the lady who's positive she knows the secret sound. Michelle.
Yes?
Now, Michelle, you have given your phone number to Lisa. And you understand, because you're pushy, you're one of those people that has 20 items, but you want to go in the 10 item or less aisle. You absolutely have to jump to the front of the line to guess the secret sound.
And well, I won't be able to get through when the time comes.
Why not?
Because I try all the time, and I can never get through.
And you're positive you're right.
I'm positive.
Just so you know, if you're wrong, we will broadcast your telephone number.
Yep.
All right.
Understand.
Then here she is. She's positive she knows it.
Here we go.
I have one question.
What, Michelle?
What's the prize?
It
still at 500?
$500.
$500.
Okay. Well, well if I if I do get it, since I'm giving out my phone number, if I don't, can I get 1,000?
No.
You know what? You know, Don?
No.
I'm half mine.
I figured it was worth a shot.
Take the opportunity away.
Yeah. Go ahead and guess.
Maybe it's because the Sacramento guy called him.
What is it?
Is it a can opener?
All right, everybody. Now, listen, and especially you people in Sacramento. I want you to call this woman, and really, I mean, when you...
Hey, don't compare me to the people in Sacramento.
I'm not. I just want them to call you, especially.
Right.
And,
that's not it.
And don't forget the time difference. Remember, when it's 9 o'clock in Sacramento, it's midnight where this lady is.
That's right. It's midnight in Sacramento. It's 3 a.m.
Phone number?
That's really not it.
Area code 703. Her phone number is 409-2329. Again, 703-409-2329.
Got it.
All right,
okay.
Michelle. See you later.
Okay.
Thank you for playing the game.
Bye-bye.
You opened that can of worms yourself.
I tried
yourself.
To say thank you to her, but she was so pushy I was unable to get it through.
There you go. I wish you could have given her a free trip to Sacramento. I wish you could have thrown that in.
Someday.
I have no response to that.
Well, now I know why you make all those bets, though. You let a little secret out a while ago. You and your pal over there.
What, did I like Sacramento?
You want to live there when you retire.
That's nice.
You want to retire in Sacramento. Well, then don't bring it up as a bet anymore, okay?
Whoever
loses the bet has to go to Maine.
You know what, Don?
It's fine with me. I like Maine. I like Maine.
I'm really going to miss you.
Clear the lines right now. I get a call 100. Rob, I think I got a few years left in me.
Yeah, but
a few years before I retire to Sacramento.
You know, you learn something every day on this show. That is a fascinating. I just picture you out there, man. What a miserable retirement it'll be. You'll be shooting people by the end of your retirement.
I really love Sacramento. And that's the truth.
It's a beautiful. It is a beautiful part of the world.
I really do.
It really is. It's a beautiful part of the world.
I just isolate myself in some compound. And then, wow, you're really doing a Sacramento dance now. Phone number 877-365-3636. This sound right here, it's not a can opener. Tell us what it is. You win a $500 prize. And don't forget the scavenger hunt. Listen now, before the end of today's show, someone's got to show up with these items. A 46 Double D bra.
Yeah.
A large bottle of mint-flavored Plax mouthwash. A 45 RPM record. A single red brick. And a green shag bathroom area rug.
Somebody should alert Colette out front that the first person with all that stuff is going to be the winner.
Win a trip to Las Vegas. You up here at WJFK with a 46 Double D bra, large bottle of mint-flavored Plax mouthwash, a 45 RPM record, a single red brick, and a green shag bathroom area rug. And you're on your way to Vegas now. Be the 100th caller. This is not pirate music. This is not scavenger hunt music. What would Bill O'Reilly say?
I'm sorry I raped that lady.
Oh, no.
All right, we'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Don't tell me they're just like letting the audience just stand out there like that. Oh, my God. Okay. Let's hurry, y'all. Seriously. This is retarded.
Retarded?
They told me they were going to do a vamp.
No, he's not retarded.
Retarded, Brittany.
Oh, no. What are they doing?
Sorry, Brittany.
Let me see.
Sorry.
I thought they were going to... I know. Well, I'm just not going to stand out. I thought they were going to vamp.
Sorry, Brittany.
Okay. Okay, thanks.
I'm retarded.
The Don and Mike Show. Always ready to tackle the clam. Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
Let me just, because they had a caller 100. Let me just prove something to you guys.
All right.
We call the world's LW. Luckiest woman. WLW. Hello?
Is that me?
Yes, that's you, the world's luckiest woman.
And would that be because the doctor said that you can't perform for a couple of weeks?
No. Although I am mighty bummed out about that.
I would say you can't do anything.
Well, I had a real explicit talk with my doctor today.
Was it fun?
No.
It was embarrassing?
It was embarrassing about sex and about my... my dislocated hip.
Well, darling, you know, I miss it, too. I want you to understand I miss it, too. But on the bright side, you know, I always look at the glass half full. It does add an extra 5 minutes to my day now.
Oh, that's nice. basically, he said, and thank goodness I have a really good personal relationship
with God,
with this doctor.
Oh, okay.
No, God hates me. With this doctor,
I was
able to. Well, that's what I keep hearing.
Well, he does, isn't he? Because you have such a nice wife. That can't be.
Oh, right, because I have such a nice wife. God doesn't hate
life,
me.
Life, I said.
Oh, life.
Interpreted as wife.
Life. Nice. Honey, listen, the jokes are sailing over your head left and right here. I'm one of God's chosen people. I know that. I'm one of God's favorites.
He told you.
Yeah, and look it up in the Bible, page 527. It says right there, me like Donnie.
Right.
He wrote it in the Bible.
Yeah.
Anyway, I didn't know she should talk about the sex thing. But, yeah, I go in for my my MRI thing today, and they're looking at the pictures. And I'm having the discussion with the doc afterwards, and he says, how are you doing? And what's up, doc?
How you doing?
And I said, you know, pretty well. I can bend over to some extent now. And, you know, keep in mind I was hit by the car on September 30th,
right.
And it's now November, what is it, 13th.
Mm-hmm.
I said, but, you know, I am as horny, you know, as O.J. Simpson. I'm the horniest man on the face of the earth. Mm-hmm. I can't do anything about it. I can't get in a position to relieve myself.
That's what I don't understand.
Yeah.
That causes you pain if you
think about it. Unless I did it, but even doing it standing up.
You have to remember.
Because you just can't get in that position?
And you have to remember, he does not, I mean, there's different, people are built different ways. His arms aren't very long.
Yeah, and that if I was to sit down, I'll show you right now.
He's got the little short stubby arms.
Oh, look at that.
If I
am sitting down like this, to go, to get my hands here, at some point while you're doing this, you flex your back a little bit. You don't just remain, your back doesn't remain totally rigid while you're doing this.
Yeah, you're probably right. I mean, it's a small muscle movement, but and that's what gives you pain?
Yes.
So, like, when you get to the point of no return, that's when the real pain would kick in and it would be excruciating?
I've tried even before I get to the point of no return. Ask my wife, honey, how are we doing on the pornos on the DirecTV?
Well, when I was in New York for those couple of days, there were a couple of purchases, but really light.
In general, I mean, I average, you know, between 5 and 100 a month.
I see you gave it the old college try when I was out of town. And
yeah, I tried. So anyway, I'm talking to the doc today, and he says, well, here's the deal. That you just, he said, I told you it would be, you know, 8 to 12 weeks before this is completely healed. He said, frankly, the only position that I could imagine you having sex in would be standing up.
And why is he imagining you having sex anyway?
Well, you know, honey, we were just talking.
All right.
We were
good.
Just talking because I brought it up.
Makes you wonder.
And then I was standing up, and he said, but you have to understand that even if you're standing up, there could be no pelvic thrust.
Yeah.
There could be no movement at all.
And don't you think I didn't get your subtle hints this morning?
What do you mean?
When you were telling me that all you could do would be to stand there. So it was out of the question.
Yeah, because the one thing that the doctor did say was, well, there certainly would be nothing that would stop you from either, meaning me, from either lying down on my back or standing up and having somebody, my wife, for instance,
with hand or mouth,
just service me.
You saw that blank look I just gave you.
Yeah, I saw that.
Right.
And I was tossing it out there,
yeah.
You know, because that's pretty much what he said was.
Well, you had a frank talk with your doctor, and you shared it with your wife.
And
no, he didn't. He just told me what he couldn't do. And normally, you know, that Mrs. Helper gene that all women have, I would be thinking of, well, we.
And I know, and I knew that, and that was kind of, you know.
No,
I just
gave him that little, like, that's a shame.
I was fishing. I'm fishing, saying, you know, God, I'm so horny, and the doctor says the MRI says I'm so close to being well, and I can't do anything, and I'm just waiting for her to say, but
stay in there.
Yeah, that's what I get. Hang
Good
in
luck
there.
To you.
Hang in there. Anyway, listen, here's the reason I called you. And you can set the record straight, because I know people will believe you. Have I or have I not mentioned to you, after I've come back from Sacramento, what a wonderful city it is, and how someday I could imagine us living there?
Yes, you have. And when you have been irate, or just thinking of other places you can move, or places you wouldn't mind being, Sacramento really has been one of the places that you've really liked. You've thought it's a really nice, perfect-sized town and a nice community.
Yeah, I mean, really, and that's really the truth. That at the time that I've been most pissed, like thinking that we might have to move the show somewhere or quit something, I've said, I've never said this to Mike, of course, because it would be the end of our partnership.
yes, indeed.
But I had said to Frieda that, you know...
No, I'd move, if I could, how close would Sacramento be to Napa?
For anybody
that's out there, if I could like drive in from wine country, I'd
closer than here.
Anyway, just wanted to clear that up.
You mean designated drive in from wine?
Yeah, that's right. Each and every day. I'm here at work. Good to be here.
Hey, you know what? You took your funny pills today, honey. you took your funny pills. Okay, thank you.
All right, boo boo.
Hey, don't forget that whole deal when we got married. You know, obey, protect, and serve. All that stuff we promised.
Marines.
No, it was,
doctor's orders.
I will obey and protect and serve my husband no matter what.
With your health, I would just rather err on the side of caution.
Oh, but honey, really, me so horny.
What if I got you? You know those kind of things they make for the disabled, the long grabber pole?
Oh, hey, that'd be like somebody else. If you use that, it'd be like somebody else doing it to you.
I could get you a couple of those.
Is it that, no pun intended,
set of tongs,
distasteful? Is the thought of simply servicing me with mouth or hand that awful to you?
No, my darling. I'll stop by the liquor store and I'll...
All right. I'll see you later. I guess I'll keep you. I love you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Yeah. I had a very frank discussion with my doctor today.
And now, what's the timetable he gave you?
He says about 3 weeks. So I'm very close. You know. But 3 weeks, I'm thinking...
If that guy that hit you had only known.
I'm thinking, Jesus Christ. However, when it does happen, watch out. Because I'm going to blow a hole through either my wife's head.
Oh, no.
Or through her stomach. Abdomen. Or if I'm by myself, through the wall.
I hate that violent imagery.
It'll be like, wow.
That's incredible. It's a long, dry spell.
It sure is. And I got to be stocking up the swimmers, man.
It'll travel all the way to Sacramento.
Wouldn't that be something if I could shoot, if my load...
Went all the way to Sacramento?
All the way to Sacramento.
Imagine that. Imagine the, you know, cross-country flights. What was that?
Yeah, then they can call and complain about it.
It'll be like, bing!
Yeah, because, you know, inevitably, if somebody out in Sacramento, what the hell is this in my yard?
Okay, call 100. No, I'm sorry, we got off track there. Hello, Don and Mike Show. Howdy. Hello. Don and Mike Show, hello.
Hello.
Hello, you're the 100th caller.
Okay.
Yes, hi.
You're okay then.
What is your name?
It's Kim.
Hi, Kim, where are you from?
PA.
From where, honey?
Pennsylvania.
From where in Pennsylvania?
Horsham.
What station are you listening on?
YSP?
YSP.
There you go. That's all right.
See, I have to know because I have prizes for each city.
YSP and PA, and thanks for calling JFK.
You have won the DVD box set of Band of Brothers, now available to own on DVD and VHS, the award-winning HBO Band of Brothers from HBO Voreal.
That is a great series.
And now you're going to play for $500
with
the secret sound, a common everyday sound that's heard in the refrigerator. Oops.
Ooh.
It's heard in the kitchen. It's heard in the kitchen. Or did I say that on purpose to throw you off? It's heard in the kitchen. It's heard in the kitchen. It's a plug-in jobber. Okay. Are you ready?
Okay.
Please don't answer until Mike sings like
P. Diddy.
And we offer you wishes of good Godspeed.
Caller, name this sound.
There it is. Well, I'd have sex in the refrigerator if I could. It's stationary like I am.
Yeah.
It's just standing there all the time. With as many compartments.
I'm the definition of half mad, half drugs. Ask the clubs, bad boy. That's what's up.
Yeah. Yeah. for.
Thank you.
For $500. Name it and claim it.
Is it the light switch with the refrigerator?
Could you be more?
When you open and close the door, the little light switches on and off.
Would it be on or off? Can I give you a hint?
I don't know if you want to.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
Oh, we're sorry.
It doesn't matter. I got nothing to do with the refrigerator. Yeah. Thank you, and don't forget that every guest
is a clue for you.
For you. Thank you for listening to the show.
All right, thanks.
Hold on just a second. I think we are all in agreement. I love it when a plan comes together. Oh, hold on. Let me give you the update here. The voting continues now.
Mm-hmm.
There have now been 46,000 votes.
Wow.
We just got 6,000 more votes on the website on WJFK.com for the American Idiot. And I'll tell you that there has been a change in leadership.
Hey, how about that?
There has been a change in leadership. One person now has 27 percentage points here with 12,000 votes.
Wow.
Another person has 24% with 11,000 votes.
Mm. Incredible.
And those two people that are running neck and neck right now in no particular order are Dave and Janet.
How about that?
My favorite.
So go to the website, WJFK.com, and vote yourself for the American Idiot. I love it when there's a show that everybody on the show watches and we all agree and we like and we can talk about. We all like The Sopranos. We always talk about that. Now, the other show that we all like and we're all watching is 24.
Oh, my God. And I think it's almost better than The Sopranos.
Again, last night, if there's a show that doesn't disappoint, it's got to be 24. Man, does that show knock my ass. I wanted to say knock my D in the dirt, but right. Really it just knocks me off my ass.
And, a show that not only is just great every week, but a particularly phenomenal episode last night when you're just, it's so well done that you're in it. And very rarely do you actually dive right into it so totally where I'm a nervous wreck watching that
show. The word is tension. The word is tension.
I probably, a lot of it has to do with the subject matter and what we've all been through.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And I said to myself, it's so different watching something like that. And when they got to that building and finally did the dirty deed last night, it was gut-wrenching. I don't think that's lost on the producers of the show either.
I finally put it together who the woman who's the assistant to the president is, not the Chinese girl, but the other girl who was on the phone with Jack all the time. Mm-hmm. She was Ensign Rowe on Star Trek, The Next Generation.
She has that kind of Star Trek look to her face.
Do you remember her, Buzz?
Yes, absolutely.
She was featured on a couple of episodes towards the end. She was real mouthy.
Right. And the daughter running down the street.
That's pretty good.
Was also a real treat.
Those boobs, and she had on that cream color top last night.
Fantastic.
I'll say this. That is one spooky-looking kid, though.
Yeah.
Kiefer Sutherland's granddaughter, I guess, on the show.
She's the nanny for that kid.
Okay,
right. And I think she's been in a lot of stuff before, too. She was
in The Patriot.
She was the little girl that didn't speak. Right.
She's one spooky-looking little kid.
She is spooky. The thing that makes 24 so cool is you really do not know. You don't know. On so many shows, especially dramas, they're not going to pop off one of the main characters.
Right.
And on 24, would anybody have ever expected that guy that was running was going to get a mouthful of radiation? Who expected that?
Maybe a week.
Right.
Maybe hours.
Right.
I loved it.
How about when they were making him take his clothes off?
Oh, my God, yeah.
He's still on the phone?
Yeah, and then he finds out from the doctor,
Yeah.
What do you have? Oh, my God, that was incredible, Rob.
Great episode.
And really, I have to applaud Fox for putting it in high def this week. Thank you, Fox.
Really, really great.
Were
you not able to watch it in high definition, even though you have high definition TV?
DirecTV has chosen not to offer the high definition channels in high def on DirecTV.
I don't understand why. I got a theory about this whole thing. I think it's like AM stereo.
No.
No,
you got to see it.
No, they're offering a lot more programming.
Guys, I'm kidding. I know it's the real deal. I know. I'm just busting Mike's balls.
I just wish.
Because you have the TV and
it to
work.
I could get it to work if I wanted to put another thing on my rental property roof, another antennae, and get over-the-air TV. But I don't want to go through that.
Anyway, great show. I also want to say that we didn't even mention this last week. I was real happy with CSI.
CSI Miami?
Yeah, no, CSI, the regular CSI,
oh, good.
That there wasn't an ending, that they didn't catch the bad guy. Yeah. I forgot to mention that last week.
Yeah, he got away.
I like that. I like that every once in a while the bad guy gets away.
They do that.
And then they give you a CSI Miami if you're looking for a nice little thing tied up in a bow. I was thinking last night as I was watching 24 that it has been a very, very long time, and maybe the first time ever, that I can remember this many dramas being this well done where you really enjoyed watching them. And mm-hmm. I think that... you know, maybe back, what was Hill Street Blues and L.A. Law, were they on at the same time?
Yeah.
They overlapped. That might have been, yeah. You know, that might have been one. But, I mean, this is the first time where you've got three just, it's you know, comedies, everybody's watched comedies.
Yeah. Right? The thing about 24 is it's like a movie. Really.
Yeah.
Every week yeah. It's like a movie. My only complaint, if I would have one, would be that I wish it was on HBO so they could have profanity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
they could go a little farther with it. But
yeah.
As far as regular TV goes...
You don't get much better.
No. 24 pretty much kicks ass.
And it's kind of cool. I mean, you know, he was understated when we had Kiefer Sutherland on the show, but he really nailed it as far as that is what creates the tension, is the fact that it is in a compacted one-day situation.
Mm-hmm. If we had him on now, we'd climb right in his anus.
Yeah.
We would all be on there with folding chairs. We love that show so much.
Isn't that amazing when you get a guest on the show that's promoting the new, you know, the new show, and you're like, yeah, we knew Kiefer Sutherland, but right now we would be, massaging him.
Kill to have him on again now.
It was really cool, because you think back, he was genuinely proud of the show.
Yeah,
that was one of the things he said, and he should have been proud.
He nailed it.
Great.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Hi, Don and Mike Show.
Hey, boys, the scavenger hunt is still on, right?
As a matter of fact, sir, indeed it is. The items we're looking for, a 46 double D bra, a large bottle of mint-flavored Plaques mouthwash, a 45 RPM record, a single red brick, and a green shag bathroom area rug.
Very good.
Bring those items right here. Dynamite World Headquarters at WJFK. You win a trip to Las Vegas.
Well, I'll see you in about a half hour.
All right.
Mm. All right.
Man, what if somebody else sees this in 15 minutes?
Well, that could be a problem.
As far as I know, that's the first guy who's called to say he's got all the items.
On his line.
Scared kids? Scary. What?
Hello, Don and Mike.
Oh, is that somebody?
Yeah. Is that a guy with the stuff already?
That's a guy with the stuff already. Looks like it.
Oh, my God.
Wow, that's fast.
Lisa, do we have a winner?
Hello?
Yeah. Hey, hold on a second there. We got a winner already.
Wow.
Wow, that'd be pretty incredible.
Let's bring this guy in. He's wearing a bra.
Hi there.
Hi, Donnie Mike.
Hi, what's your name?
Jason.
Jason, one by one, let's go through the items. 46 double D bra. I'm no fag. I'm going to have to look at the bra to see the size.
I have to be completely honest. It's actually a 44 double D. Kmart was sold out.
Then I am sorry you are not a winner.
I'm sorry.
Get out of here.
Right, and let me see that bottle of Plaques.
Yes.
Let me look at it just in case when you got to it.
Not close enough. Not
no, that's not nearly the largest
thing,
size.
No, I live with my grandparents. They live in their house for 20 years. They have the original furniture, carpet. I actually cut this out of their bedroom.
I hate to say it again, but we were looking for an entire area rug.
Let me just tell everybody what this guy has done wrong. He has the wrong size bra.
Right.
He has the wrong size bottle of mouthwash.
Right.
He didn't bring an entire green shag bathroom rug. He
just a pack.
Cut off a corner. Did you at least get the record right and the brick?
I don't think so. That doesn't look like a 45, is it?
This was out of their record box.
That's a 78.
78.
Yeah. No, 4 out of the 5 things you got wrong.
Wow. Yeah.
Well, hey, but you made an effort, and I applaud you for that.
All right.
He lets me keep the Plaques. Good man.
The contest is alive.
Yes.
Wait, we have another guy coming. Don, there's another guy coming in right now.
Ready, Lisa. All right.
Another guy coming in.
We live in
Mateys.
Hey. Right. Hi there. What's your name?
I'm John.
Hi, John. Where are you from?
I'm from Springfield.
All right, Johnny, what do you got for us?
I bring from the land of Tarjay. I know that that's one of your favorites.
Yes, it is. Thank you.
Okay, first of all, we got for you, Mr. Geronimo, we have a 46 double D bra.
There it is. As a matter of fact, it says, yes, it is just my size, 46 double D bra.
Perfect.
That is one item correct.
Rob, I believe you wanted a 45. Here's a Duran Duran, Hungry Like the Wolf.
He'll use that.
Two for two.
And then we have, of course, for Buzz, who's behind me, as I know from hearing the show. I won't throw it through.
No, don't throw it, but that's the right brick. Yeah.
He has a single red brick.
Right.
I'll leave it out here
for you,
Buzz.
There you go.
Thank you.
You can keep it if you want.
Thank you, I will.
It's a little muddy.
That's fine.
This guy is so energized. All right. It's hysterical.
Okay.
Look at
that. And then we have Lisa. We have a beautiful Royal Legacy Martex.
That is it.
Something for this ad.
Lisa, I guess that's what was in your mind when you
green
said it, right?
Green shag bathroom area rug. Is that what you had in mind, Lisa? Right.
Absolutely.
Brilliant. Exactly. And?
Yeah, oh, by the way, for a bribe, I brought you a diabetic Coke.
Never hurts.
I love it, and I've had one myself. I see I already have one, but there's a second. Cool.
I go through quite a few. And finally?
Now, you wanted a big bottle of Plex.
Right,
I only,
right.
I got you not only a big bottle of Plex, but 33% more free.
And I'm going to tell you, there are two, when the other guy came in with the bottle of Plex, I was going to say one thing. I was going to say, there are two other sizes larger than this, and I would have accepted either one of them, and this is one of those sizes.
How many ounces in that large size bottle?
32 fluid ounces. There's the industrial, like Costco one, but I'm accepting either this one or the big one. That means we got a winner.
Together.
We did it.
Let's put our hands together.
You're the man.
Thank you, Ryan.
Jeff, congratulations. You have won a trip for two to Las Vegas.
Sweet.
To see the Ultimate Fighting Championship Friday, November 22nd.
All right.
You will be staying at the MGM Grand. Your trip includes round-trip air, two nights hotel, and tickets to the Ultimate Fighting Championship.
Awesome. Do you realize he turned this around in 51 minutes?
That's incredible.
That's pretty amazing.
That's pretty great.
That's amazing.
That's pretty great.
Yeah, that is fantastic.
I have to give kudos to my neighbor, Rob, who gave me the Hungry Like the Wolf album.
Hey, whatever way you got it, man. Doesn't matter.
Now I feel bad for that guy who just called and said, I'll be there in 25 minutes.
And we had two guys, and there might be like three more in the parking lot.
Yeah. That's a TS if you're already on your way here, but this the scavenger hunt is over.
Yeah, excellent job. Really.
Thank you.
No idea. We'll have to make it harder next time.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. All right, congratulations. Have a great time in Vegas.
Great, I will.
We love it out there.
That's good news.
There you go.
And you got a diet of vanilla Coke out of it.
Always bet on black. That's what Wesley Snipes told me.
You can give the brick the buzz.
Bring Buzz the brick.
He likes those things. He just want to throw it through the window.
Yeah, it'd be easier.
He was very hyper, like one of those guys doing an oven commercial on television.
Yeah, that's right. Here you go. Look at the stain. It came right out.
Wow, I'm amazed we got a winner in that contest already.
And how about that guy? I feel sorry for him in a way. The guy that
had 4 out of 5 wrong?
Just a dollar short on like every item.
He had the 44 Double D bra, not 46. Mm-hmm. He had a small bottle of mouthwash, not large.
Right.
He had a 78 RPM record, not a 45. He had just a small piece of a green shag rug. The only thing he got right was the brick.
I got the brick.
That's all he got was just the brick.
Wow, that's great. I like that. Yeah. Scavenger hunt is fun.
And Buzz, a couple more, you'll be able to have a brick house. Hello, Donna Mike Show. Hello.
Donna Mike.
Yeah, hi. You
guys are beautiful.
Thank you.
I'm a blind guy. I lost my eyesight in 1994. I'm 53 years old, and I've been listening to you guys since about 10 years now. And I grew up on the East Coast, and I know you guys attend Phillips Crab House all the time.
Down at the shore.
Oh, yes.
Down at the
I went to military school and graduated in 1968 from McDonough School near Pikesville with Jeff Phillips and Steve Phillips.
The only reason I'm even entertaining this boring call is because the guy's blind.
The guy is blind. And
hey,
those
I'm a good blind guy over here from the East Coast.
And that would be Phillips guys that run the restaurant.
Yes, Jeff and Steve.
Jeff and Steve Phillips.
Yes.
All right, sir. Well, thank you for your patronage
and your patriotism.
All right. Thanks, guys. You're the best.
Bye. Thank you.
All right. Bye.
Bye-bye. I'm sorry God had to punish you for some reason.
As you hold your 46 Double D bra. What a lovely bra. I mean, that's a really quality item, it looks like.
Nice.
Do you want to give it away?
No, we should hang it on the wall with you.
We're hanging on the wall? Okay.
Yeah, let's hang it on the wall.
All right.
Hello, Don and Mike Show. Hello. God knows my wife can't fit into it. I got no problem saying that after the stuff she said about me today.
Your wife, the size of your wife, she could parachute with it.
Hello.
Don Mike Show, radio god.
You said it, not me. Hello.
That
was not a breast joke. That was a your wife is petite joke. Yeah. I was not commenting on her bosoms.
Hello.
Mike.
Yes, sir.
Hey, I got a good way for you to enjoy 24 even more. Play the 24 drinking game. Every time someone gets shot, take a drink. Every time someone's on a cell phone, take a drink. Yeah. Every time someone says, where are you? Take a drink.
You know, hold on a second. There's a website somewhere. That, you know, this all started with the Bob Newhart show.
Right.
That whenever someone said, hi, Bob, you would have a drink. There are drinking games for every show out there.
Right.
There's even, I've even been to more than one website where there are drinking games for our show.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, really.
What are the things that we have to say?
I don't even remember.
Because if we knew that, if we could get on one of those websites and just familiarize ourselves, even on a, you know.
Every time I call somebody a douchebag or every time, I don't know, what is your, for a while you had some crutch phrase.
I want to tell you.
All right, I want to say, I'll tell you right now.
I'll tell you right now.
But you would say, I'll tell you right now.
I still
now.
Say that. I'll tell you right now.
Or when Rob says whore.
Right.
You know, would be take a double shot and do
it. I say with, naturally or wow.
Yeah, with Buzz it was wow.
Mm-hmm. Boy, I'd love to know what that game is.
Anyway, I'm sure someone will find it and call us with it. Hello, Don and Mike.
Hey, boys, I'm the BM eater that was 25 minutes away.
Oh, sorry about that, pal.
Oh, dear. Enjoy your break.
Close and yet so far. You know, you missed out on The Way We Were by Barbra Streisand. I just want to point that out.
Oh, was that the 45 you had?
Yeah, I ran into Orpheus Records in Arlington, and I said, I need a 45 RPM. And he says, we don't sell 45s. And I said, I just need any 45. And he says, well, you can have this if you want, so... You know, thanks to him. And,
it's on my original audition tape.
Is it really?
But
the
now way we were, yeah. With a 46 double D bra. I don't know what to do with that.
All right, my friend. Well, have fun. You know.
All right, boys.
Get your jerk on in it. You know.
The Way We Were, Heartbeat, It's a Love Beat, Space Race by Billy Preston, and Love's Theme.
Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Hey.
Sounds like a great mix, Mike.
It was a fantastic mix. And, Don, you'll notice all of those great talk-up records.
Hello, Don and Mike.
How's it going?
Okay.
Hey, you should have another contest. Who can fill that bra? And that, you give a trip to, Atlantic City.
There you go. Junior producer. Thank you, my friend.
Bye.
You're a JP.
You are. Who doesn't want to, grab the cans of cat food under those breasts?
Don and Mike Show.
Hey, Don, Mike.
Yeah.
You were talking about how close you were to Napa. Mike, if you moved to Sacramento.
Yeah, how close is it?
It's probably maybe an hour and a half, but the closest thing is Reno.
Right.
You're an hour away from Reno.
Now, we know that we've made that trip before through the mountains.
Yeah, that's a tough trip.
We miss you down there. When you came to the El Dorado, that was a blast.
Yeah, we do love Reno. Man, we do love Reno.
In wintertime, we would broadcast from our homes.
Reno kicks ass. That is one great city.
With phone lines. Hello. We just do the show like that. Right, Kev?
We got a break. We will be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Donovan back to pass. He's got a man open in the end zone. It's Joe Artinger. The pass is there, and he drops the ball. And the Eagles do not win the Super Bowl. And as we review this Super Bowl, it was all Joe Artinger's fault.
The Don and Mike Show.
You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe.
We are.
I had it out there here with the likes of your people.
Broadcasting from sea to shining sea. Hello, ladies. The Don and Mike Show.
Right. Go to WJFK.com. To vote for your favorite of the American Idiots. We were on the computer last night, my family and I, having a good time actually clicking on the MP3s and hearing the people singing. We had real nice speakers on our computer, and the performances are pretty great.
Awesome performances by each and every one of our contestants.
Yeah. We're up to 49,000 total votes now, and same person's in the lead.
Hmm.
13,290 votes, and the second place person has 12,170 votes.
All right.
And those two people in no particular order are Janet and Dave.
Very good.
Today on the show, George Papadopoulos.
Papadopoulos.
The Blackjack Master.
Uh-huh.
That's good because you and I are going to Atlantic City in a couple of weeks.
Yes, looking forward to that.
And we're going to be playing Blackjack like crazy. He's going to come in and teach us the secrets. Tomorrow, Fred Keel, he's the guy who's written the book O.J.'s Dog Days. Again, a serious book written from the perspective of O.J.'s dog, who was the only eyewitness to Nicole Simpson's murder.
So I would assume that this book is a theory book, where he actually puts it together, what would have happened based on it, if it was through the eyes of the dog.
I believe he's actually sat down with the dog. You know, they have, like, dogs.
This is the most confusing guess because...
They have dog psychologists and junk like that.
Right. So he's spoken to the dog. Well, it can't be serious.
Well, I don't... Mike, I've talked to a lot of people and said, if it's a gag book, I don't want the guy on the show. And everybody to me has said, no.
So we don't have a copy of the book yet.
No, we don't. It's the book's not out yet. It's not published yet.
But it might be... Is there a chance that it could be, like, from the... Like he's reconstructing the crime or something? Or is he sitting down and going... Because, you're looking at me saying, it's a serious book.
This is what I've been told. Mm-hmm. The guy is writing the book. Only the dog knows what really happened.
That's right.
And somehow the guy has, spoken to the dog. I don't know if it's telepathically or what.
We'll find out.
But anyway...
Yeah, getting mixed signals all over the place here.
Yeah, now I'm getting into my headphones. The dog spoke to him via barking.
Oh,
hey!
Okay.
Okay?
All right. Now I understand. I'll take that seriously.
Coming soon. Well, he wants to be taken seriously.
Well, that's his problem.
Tomorrow on the show, that guy, the OJ guy, plus Mr. Skin tomorrow. Very soon, the girls from iBolt.com are coming in.
Ooh, they were in here once before.
They're coming back to do naked yoga. We have a sexpert coming on the show, Dr. Patty. Here's the deal. She's hawking these pillows that you can put into different positions to have sex on.
Wonderful.
And the girls from Amazing Entertainment are coming by, and they're going to be demonstrating the positions.
Wonderful. That should be a very festive day.
Also, very soon, we'll be talking about our annual dinner on the Mayflower. Actually, it's not annual. We do it like once every 5 years. Mike, the Hanukkah guy's coming up very soon. Hanukkah, I think the first day is the 30th. And the American Idiot winner live in concert.
Lots going on the show.
All of those events coming soon right here on this show. Don and Mike show. Hello, you're on the air. Hi.
Yeah, hey, Don. It's Sal over Manassas. I was just curious. You were talking about how you could lie on your back and be okay. Why don't you lie on your back and let Frida ride the baloney pony?
Because let me just explain to you. I have a dislocated hip.
Uh-huh.
If I'm on the bottom, and when we have sex, that's always how I like it, is that me on the bottom and her on top. Her, just the fact that she's putting weight on that area of
that
my body.
That causes the hip to hurt.
Yes, and actually could even pop the hip out.
Ooh. Do you ever do any other position than you on the bottom?
Uh-uh. That's what I like.
What if you have a board underneath your back? Then your pelvis doesn't move.
No, I don't.
Well, then you get the same effect that if you laid on your back on the kitchen floor.
Yeah, the pressure's not good.
But even if you laid on a, the thing is.
What if you got a couple of, straps?
Here's the thing, though. Think about it. Think about when you're having sex, even if it's involuntary, you can't lay there.
Let me see if I can remember.
You got to, you got to thrust. You gotta.
Yeah, you're right. You do have to thrust.
You gotta have some kind of motion going, and that's what the doc tells me. That's killing me.
Get a swing.
And Buzz, she did tell me to ask you about your bamboo swing.
Well, that would kill you. That would hurt more.
Yeah. And besides, I don't want to use Buzz's bamboo swing, as I told my wife, because Jesus, Buzz's DNA is all over that.
Oh, I'm sure he'd sanitize it for your protection.
Oh, yeah. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hey, good afternoon, gentlemen.
Hey.
I have a very, very relevant question you can ask the author tomorrow. How was the dog paid for his services in the book?
All right, these are all valid questions.
Sausages?
That we will bring up tomorrow.
I wanted to say hi to a guy that's a big fan of the show. It's either John or Mike. I forgot because I was running out of the place. I think it's a John or a Mike, and he works at the cardiologist's office that I was at. And I said I'd get his name on the air and say hello because he was a huge fan as he was taking my blood pressure. And there you go. Hello. It's nice to go into any kind of like specialist office when you're dealing with your ticker and you're a little nervous. And I was was playing with the artificial heart that they had in there. And then he came in and he said an amazing amount of very kind things about our show. And, you know, I that goes rewarded now.
And how long until you die?
He was not the doctor. The doctor came in later, and she estimated that I think I will be fine through Friday's show. And I know that's always important for you to get me to do that Friday show.
Yeah. Good, because, you know, that's your bit every week, Jeopardy. And right. After that, I think you and I got to get the package deal on that Al Roker surgery.
Yeah. I asked about that today. I actually asked my cardiologist about that surgery today.
Did you really?
I asked about it. Yeah, I did. And, you know, she just said, you know, she wasn't, as many doctors are, not thrilled with the idea of doing it. But, you know, doctors nowadays are very, do you find, they're committal, but they're not totally. I mean, they throw everything out there. They give you all the information. But you get the impression, at least I do with medical professionals, that it's up to you to make the kind of decision that you make.
Well, here's the thing. I'm watching that show last night. I think a lot of people watch the Al Roker show. And incidentally, he had the fat taken out of the wrong part of his body.
Right.
He should have done something about those whale-like jowls that he's got.
It's amazing that a man can lose that much weight and not lose it at all in his face.
Yeah. Right. I'm watching that last night, and they're saying that Al Roker weighed, I think, 320 pounds. Well, what was it, Rob?
He topped off at 320 at the Olympics.
320 at the Olympics.
Right.
And Frieda and I were watching this thing last night, and I'm thinking... I said, well, that would be an easy way to go, to drop the weight.
Right.
And she said, well, how much do you weigh? I said, I weigh 235. She says, you're probably not fat enough.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Probably, even though I'm fat, you're not fat enough to go in and have that surgery done.
You have to be morbidly obese, and that's what the doctor, the cardiologist said. That is dramatic stuff. That is what they have to do.
I was talking to Carrie last night that, do you think there's anybody that saw that special and said, man, if I can put on 10 more pounds, I can get that surgery.
Now, that's when I ran out of my cardiologist's office, you know, thinking there are 3 or 4 more pounds where I'll be able to pop right back in. No, what she said was this is a reversible procedure. It's not permanent.
Oh, you mean when they made Al Roker's stomach?
I think there are different ways they can do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Some of them are reversible. The reversible ones are like any drug that you take, any medicine that you take, anything that you change, you alter yourself, it's not going to be as good as behavior modifications. I left the office crying.
Al Roker's stomach is the size of what?
An egg.
The size of an egg.
It was the size of a football. Now it's the size of an egg.
Also, vitamins, nutrients, when you do that, you don't absorb them into your system, and so it's a little
different.
The part of the show I loved was did you see when he was talking about?
I didn't watch it. I didn't watch the show.
Well, you should have seen it, because it was Al Roker in the kitchen cooking, and he was describing how now he can eat with his wife, who incidentally is a real piece of ass.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah, yeah. A news anchor up in New York.
She works for ABC, and he was describing how he can now eat in front of her, that he used to have a meal, and then he would go eat by himself. And God, would I love a videotape of that. Al Roker just going to a special room to eat.
He'd have a meal, and then he would go off and eat another meal himself?
Eat by himself.
Wow.
Yeah.
He can't eat in front of his wife. How funny is that?
That's great. Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Where's your crap detector now?
Is that the second time for that guy?
Yeah.
Second time today, I think.
Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah, it is.
Herndon.
Source.
Yeah.
Where's JB?
You mean we really are in here?
Yeah.
Joe, where'd you go?
All right. Well, tell him we called.
Was on him.
Same guy again.
Son of a bitch.
Same guy again. And the Eagles lose the Super Bowl. All right. Bye, Herndon.
Bye now.
Bye-bye. Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Hey, Don.
Yeah.
Got two questions for you. Actually, I got one thing to tell you about the fat people getting their stomach cut that you're talking about.
Yeah.
And then I got another question. But
anyway,
I know a girl had that surgery, and she said that she only took 1 p.m. a week after that, but it smelled like hell.
Oh, I bet.
She couldn't fart or nothing like that.
Okay.
Secondly.
Thanks.
Thank you, doctor.
All right. Secondly, I don't know if you can answer this, but since your accident, how has Frieda been getting service?
Probably the same way, really, that she achieves orgasm throughout our marriage by herself. I mean, I'm not...
He's liking that you hear a little chuckle in the back.
I don't know why you're laughing. Even when I get it on with my wife.
Maybe you could bring something home that's egg-shaped.
I'm always much faster than she is.
Well, they,
although they, you know,
you can't
is that going to get on the air?
Probably not.
I don't think so.
And tell me that you love me.
Yes, now, in fact, I guess, but I don't know. Because even then, if you think about me performing oral on my wife, laying on my back, and her straddling me, you get the involuntary hip action. There's body language involved. I'll tell you what does scare me a little bit. They gave me this thing to take home, this little, those electrolyte things, they got the little, the rubbery things on them.
The electrodes?
Yes, electrodes, yeah. And they got wires that are hooked up to a battery thing.
It's really a muscle stimulator.
And every night.
You do that on your own?
Yeah, the insurance paid for it.
Wow.
And every night I have to lay down on the bed on my stomach, and my wife puts these things strategically on my back on the spots that are the worst, and you turn it on, and again,
so the fun
these days, I might have to smell them because I think she might be using it.
Oh.
I mean, I think she might be really...
Why not?
...really using it because she's mentioned...
I would imagine, having been to a chiropractor and had the electrodes put on my back as often as I have, and when you get that low-grade vibration before the... I like them to bring it right up to almost the pain threshold.
So do I.
But I would imagine, like, at lower levels...
Uh-huh.
Ooh, la, la.
Anyway, she's mentioned to me...
Men and women.
She has said that is fantastic. And she's said, I've thought about using it. And I've actually seen her use it on her neck. Uh-huh. And she'll take the little strips off my back.
You get to keep that?
Yeah, that's part of the old man's insurance pays for that.
But you get to keep the unit. It's not so expensive that you have to bring it back or anything.
I think it's moderately expensive, but I get to keep it, yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just imagine the fun you two.
Yeah.
And you know what? In your condition, maybe you should try it.
What, on my D?
Sure. It's what it is basically a vibrator.
Yeah, but what I need on my D, though, what I need is the friction. You need friction.
Well, not necessarily. As a matter of fact, I would venture to say that you could probably...
You think I could get off?
I know people have with vibrators. Guys have done that.
This isn't really a vibrator. This uses electrical impulses to cause muscles to contract, and your knee isn't a muscle.
Yeah, well, yes, it is.
No,
it's a love muscle.
No, well, it's what it's called.
No, but I mean the stimulation is all that matters. It's getting that area stimulated, and I would venture to say it would work.
You've got to get the
not necessarily. You could do that by fluctuating the voltage.
Oh, I don't think so. You know what? Maybe I'll bring the thing in tomorrow.
Right.
And I'll let you put it on your hand.
Yeah, I'd like to see that.
And you can actually test out the voltage yourself.
Because it's like a vibrator.
Well, not really.
Exactly.
But I mean, it's the same sensation if you put, you know, if you put something that's
only on a muscle. Know. Does it do that though?
No, vibrator works on a.
A vibrator does, but the electrical stimulation, the electrodes only work on muscles.
Well, no, doesn't it work on nerve endings also?
No, I don't think so.
Yeah, it's electrical current.
Yeah.
You're going to feel it if you put it there.
Hmm. You know, I think Mike's right about that. I think no matter where you put it, you turn it on, you get that hum, you get that...
You're going to get sensation wherever you put that thing, whether it's on a muscle or not.
It's got
what
one
designed to do, of course, is to get into the muscle and cause the muscles to
contract.
Go into... But I would imagine that whatever the current goes through, nerve endings and what have you, and whatnot...
It's got one setting that just gives you these constant bursts that are just, it's wow.
It just doesn't get any better than this.
You know, I couldn't imagine putting it on my D, though.
In our listening audience, you know we've got somebody that's tried this.
All right. Well, we're looking for a lot of things now. We're looking for the drinking game about the
We're looking
show.
For Plaque's mouthwash.
No, you got your Plaque's mouthwash, Mike. You got it. You got your big bottle. You got two bottles of it today.
Yeah, but the last guy was here. I didn't take one from him.
Hello.
I felt a little guilty.
Donna Mike.
How you doing, Donna Mike?
Hey, we're doing great.
Hey, you know, why don't you get one of those, battery-operated vaginas?
Okay, I'll rush right out and get that. Where do they sell those? CVS?
Oh, any of those little sex shops. You should be able to look it up on that website that you had on there.
Didn't we have one of those in here?
We had one up in New York.
It was modeled after a famous actress, and yeah. I can't remember who it was.
A porn star.
Not Lynn Redgrave?
Hello, Don and Mike show.
I was going to say, we could do another scavenger hunt. Have them bring one of those in.
I don't want to use a plastic vagina.
If it was Lynn Redgrave, it would have had bigger majora.
Hello. Labia. Labia majora. Hello.
Redgrave.
Hi, Don. On my show.
Hi.
Hi.
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, of course.
Hi, this is Katie, and you know what?
What?
I am a New Yorker, and I'm here in D.C., and I had to get on the phone and call you guys because I have to get you back on the air in New York. I can't live without you.
Make it your personal quest.
There won't be a chance.
I know. I'm serious. What can I do?
Not a chance. Well, you got 80 or 90 million bucks, you can buy a radio station. Because that's about what it's going to take.
Oh, my God. Are you kidding?
No.
You're the best.
Oh, well, thank you.
Oh, that's very sweet of you.
Thank you. Too bad there weren't 2 or 3 million more people who shared that opinion in New York, or we'd still be on there.
Oh, my God. I'm going to... letter writing campaign, phone calls.
Oh, no, that never works. Although, I got to tell you that we do take some weird, perverse pleasure in the demise of... the good ship WNEW as it continues to sink further and further off the face of the earth.
But there's no one there to open the mail.
And what I've heard is that on Thanksgiving,
yeah,
they're going to start that ridiculous, we're going to play Christmas music all the time. And they're going to do that until the first of the year, and then that's when they're going to be soft rock. Is the first of the year.
Really?
No.
Oh my God.
Either that or country, because they hired a guy from, I just heard yesterday they hired a guy from US 99 in Chicago. It's a big country station in Chicago.
So it's either going to be soft rock or country.
Right. Oh. But either way, they're going to start with the all Christmas stuff.
Yeah. Good luck to them.
Good.
I miss you guys.
We miss you too. Mm-hmm. Come visit us. We have apartments there.
Really? Hey.
Yeah.
Is that an invitation?
Pretty smart that we decided to keep those apartments.
Yeah, those empty apartments. But you can use it anytime.
Pretty smart. Oh, you know what? I was supposed to ask you this. I guess I should ask you off the air.
Well, go ahead. Buzz, talk for a second.
All right. Don and I need to discuss what they're going to do about their empty apartments in New York, since it doesn't look like we'll be going back to WNEW or any other New York radio station, at least not anytime soon. So the question is, what to do with the apartments?
Oh, okay. All right. Settled.
Just tell her that there are two channels that she might want to avoid.
All right.
That I bought full time. No, I think that, you know, I think that's run out. I don't think I renewed that.
Beautiful. Well, thank you. I thank you, and she thanks you, and the rest of them.
And that lady on the phone sounds like a hottie.
Yeah.
Wow. You want the show to go down the toilet right away?
Well, I don't know what you got planned.
Hey, it's Robert the Mailman.
Why I got to go down the toilet because of me?
All I know is, Robert, I'm on a schedule today. I can give you exactly 2 minutes.
All right.
For whatever it is you want to say. And this includes anybody that wants to have a rebuttal to Robert.
Oh, that's not fair.
Because Robert... Well, I ain't got no racial thing to talk about.
All right, here he is.
But, however, can Robert, you take me...
Robert the Mailman, go.
Take me off the air.
I can't. Why do I have to take you off the air?
Because what I got to tell you, I can't say on the air. It's that bad.
Oh, my God. It's something hot with Don. You better talk to him.
All right. Hold on.
Don's going to talk to Robert the Angry Mailman off the air. Still counts on his 2 minutes.
What is it?
What could this possibly be?
Yeah, you're not on the air.
Well, Don's talking to him right now.
What kind of news from Robert the Angry Mailman?
Who the hell knows?
Yeah, I guess.
You know, Robert has said so many bad things on the air.
Yeah.
So many things that make me cringe. So many things
imagine.
That have just come from Satan that I can't imagine what it could be that would be so awful that he would feel it necessary that he had to share it with Don off
right.
the air.
Hold on, Robert.
I'm afraid to ask.
Well, we have the answer, I'm afraid.
I understand why. It's, Robert, and I mean this seriously, you should call the police.
Oh, no, they already... That's
all
right. Listen, hey, Don.
Yeah.
Come on, man.
Wait, are you all right, Robert?
No, Robert, I've not let any of your secret go by saying you should call the police.
But I think... it's taken care of. Okay?
But...
Hey, hey.
Is he upset?
Out here, pal.
He's upset.
What, are you mad at me now?
No. Everything's cool with you, man.
I think... But I
it's taken care of. It's taken care of, man.
How can I be taken care of?
Oh, this is killing me. This is killing me in our audience.
So, I just told her, stay away from me.
What's he got, a stalker?
You told the person you just talked to me about, you told her to stay away from you?
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
But now, did you tell the police what you told me about
her? Hey! Come on, man!
What?
Don't mention the DD.
Robert, listen. Now I'm being serious. You're calling up and you're talking about a crime that was committed.
Hey, excuse me. Didn't I just tell you this stuff off the air, pal?
Yeah.
They already know.
Let me tell you something, pal. If they already know, then why are you calling me, telling me it on the radio? I'm just giving you good advice.
You're my friend. You're a confidant, man. It's a baby mama update.
Is everything all right, Robert?
No, Mike.
And Robert, I am talking about your safety and the safety of anybody else, and certainly with what you were telling me about in confidence, I would urge you, since it is a...
Yeah?
You know, call the cops.
They know already.
Okay.
They have already been informed. If there was something to be done else...
Are you in danger?
If there was something else to be done... Done, my friend. It would be done.
Are you in danger, Robert?
Well, then, Robert, then I'm...
Oh, you know I'm taking care of myself.
No, well, then, Robert, I'm glad you did that.
I mean, that was
the prudent...
No, I didn't do it. It was done before, you know...
Then it was the prudent thing to do. Yeah.
I expected as soon as I heard about...
Well, I want to tell you, you know what you should
do? Situation because...
You should on a scale of 1 to 10, how bad is this?
You know, such and such.
10. It's a 10 on how bad it is. It's 10.
Wow.
Don't even guess. I'll tell you during the commercials.
It's killing me.
I know. Well, it's his fault. He calls up on the radio and says, I want to talk to you off the radio.
I hope he's all right. He's a friend of the show. I hope everything's all right.
No, he's all right.
Good.
He's all right. Boy, Robert.
Did he hang up?
Yeah, he just hung up.
Did he get pissed?
Yeah. I don't know why he's pissed.
Hey, Robert, what'd you hang up for?
No, I don't get it.
Me neither.
No, I don't get anything because I don't know what's going on.
Well, I can't.
He's obviously distraught, and you said it's 10 on a scale of 1 to 10, so it's got to be something bad.
That's bad.
I don't know. I don't feel I can talk about it on the radio because he asked me not to say
it. No, and that's right. Yeah, you honor that when people ask you that.
Yeah, but, wow. Well, Robert, Jesus, you know, watch your back.
Wow.
Yeah, or whatever.
Crazy world.
You have to do. Hello, Don and Mike. I'm sorry to be so cryptic.
You're honoring.
And
him.
I would tell you what the guy. I would tell all you guys listening what he said to me, but he really asked me not to.
Yeah.
And really, frankly, it's something I don't think you want to hear on the radio.
Okay.
I mean, it's spooky. It's like bad stuff.
Okay.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Hey, Don and Mike. I was hoping that Robert would be on. This is Mark in Sacramento. I was hoping that I could talk to him and
tell him
to go away. Whatever the hell problems he's got, just please
why?
Go away. And Don.
Why?
Two minutes is 120 seconds.
Sir, I ask you, why do you want Robert to go away?
Because he's just an annoying... I mean, I'd rather hear Dennis Murphy for three times as long.
All right, hold on.
And Gavin for 10 times as long.
He's bad.
Hey, pal, change the channel.
Oh, you're back. All right, come on.
Change the channel, Tritt. Okay, I don't need you.
All right, this is real. Come on.
Who cares about Dennis Murphy?
Take it to your boys or whoever you've got. But
what boys? I don't have to talk to my boys.
If you don't want to go in there with them, just stay away.
Why would I stay away?
It's a lightning rod for arguments.
Get up there, bitch.
Hey, we don't like you. We don't want to hear you.
Who's we?
Lose the phone number.
Who's we, white man?
Right here, boy.
Hey, now watch it, dude.
Hey, watch it. Douche from Sacramento, watch your mouth.
Oh, I'm sorry. Did
yeah,
I
you
say
should
something
be.
To offend? He is offensive.
Yeah, but you know, you don't need to pull that crap.
I need to pull one of these because that's what the bottom line is.
I agree with Robert.
I know how the white man thinks. That's cool.
Oh, I'm glad you know how the white man thinks, because you're so lonely, isn't that right?
My black ass.
Okay,
how about
that?
I just have to be uppity.
All right, hold on a second. All right, I got rid of the guy in Sacramento.
Yeah.
All right, so Robert is back.
Yeah, man.
Hi, Robert.
I didn't hang up. Some guy, the phone hung up. I didn't hang up on
you. Okay. All right, but you're okay.
I'm not, of course I'm okay. It's just that, okay, number one, all those tricks I was screwing...
Yeah.
I fired all of them. Okay.
Right, you fired all your girlfriends.
Right. All of them got fired.
All right. Good.
Well, a couple of them asked me to marry them. I said no.
Okay.
But
yeah, because you're such a catch, Robert.
Huh?
What?
Because you're such a catch.
I am a catch, Trump.
I said it, Robert. It was me.
It was Mike who said it.
It was me.
I know why Mike said that, but I ain't got none in the last decade.
But Robert, you're cool. You're cool with everything you told me, right?
It's upsetting to me, and if the situation was a little better, you know, I would take care of things once said child is here.
Okay.
If you know what I'm saying.
Yeah, wow. All right, Christ. Well,
that's what the situation is now.
All right, as long as you told the cops, then that's fine.
No, Don, listen. Okay, number one, I read about everything in the newspaper like everybody else. Okay? She talked to me a couple of times, and gave me some gray area stuff. So I said, I don't want to hear no more.
You know, Robert, here's the deal. Now we're talking about this on the radio, and I'm going to have to put you on hold now because we're talking about...
No, I know. I just picked up on something.
You
better
serious.
Knock it off if you don't want it to be on the radio.
Something that's serious, Robert. And
yeah, it is serious, man.
Well,
I mean, I know it is, and it's not funny.
God knows it's not funny. I mean, it's
you know
awful.
What? Only you, and probably God being left of the nation now, knows about it. But, you know, it would take some thinking to figure it out because it's not a recent event.
No, I don't think anybody could figure out what it is, but I think people are...
But it's pretty bad, right?
Yes, it's awful. And if there's anything you know...
That's the thing.
Okay.
I don't know anything.
All I'm saying is if there's anything you know that could help the cops, I would hope you would tell them that.
Take me off the air again.
All right,
I'll tell you. Hold on.
All right, you're off the air.
I'm starting to get pissed off right now.
Frustrating.
Sorry, I don't mind being out of the loop, but what the F is going on here?
No, it sounds spooky.
It does sound weird. It sounds pretty heavy duty. Yeah, I'll find
out. Okay. All right, hold on.
Very scary.
All right, now this is good news. So they caught the bad guy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Right. Oh. Right.
They're talking about Saddam Hussein.
Is he in town?
All right. Okay. But what about your baby's mama? Huh? Just like. Oh, Robert, I never thought I would say this. Call me tomorrow in the office. Okay, I can't discuss this with you now. We're on the radio.
Wow.
All right, bye. Bye, brother. That's some nasty ass, man.
Wow.
Let me tell you this, because I know you're dying to know what it is.
Mm-hmm.
There was a crime, a heinous crime that was committed that Robert was telling me about.
Mm-hmm.
They have apprehended the persons who conspired to commit this awful crime.
Is it okay that you're saying this on the air?
Yeah, I'm just telling you what he's told me.
Mm-hmm.
That's all I'm telling you.
Yeah, but what he told you off the air that he didn't want you to tell.
Well,
is that, I mean...
As far as I know, it's public record. I know
all
what
right.
he's talking about.
Mm-hmm. Well, but I don't know.
I know. Listen, what am I going to do? The guy calls me up. I'm just telling everybody.
I just want to make sure you're not saying anything that he was telling you, you know, not to...
When he said
put on hold, it sounds like he was a little scared.
No, he's not scared at all.
He's not scared. All right. Well, I don't know.
He's not scared. He's Robert.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right.
I don't know really what the deal is with this situation.
Would this have been a call that you would have appreciated in the office, perhaps, and not during the middle of the show?
Yeah. Absolutely. You bet your ass. But it is a call that I'm glad he called, and I'm glad that I heard what I heard from him. And
you're involved now, you know, now that he's called you.
Oh, so are you. You're here with me.
I'm not going to listen when you try to tell me what it is. I'm going to go,
la, 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 la. No, you're dying to find out what
I am dying to find
you're
out.
I'm dying to tell you.
I know you are.
If you'll pardon the pun. So let's break.
Jesus.
And just imagine how this might sound.
There you go.
There you go. That'll change the mood for a second. You're listening to 102.7 WNEW.
Thank you for the call, Robert.
Wow. You know, I'm sorry that was so cryptic, folks. Ooh, really, I don't know what I can and
well,
can't
you were.
There.
I mean, you were basically going along with his wishes, which is
put in a very awkward position.
Yeah, I mean, and you didn't do that; he did that.
All right, we'll break and we'll come right back. Okay.
God, I can't wait.
It's always exciting coming to work here.
Mm-hmm.
God, anybody, any of you guys thinking about getting into radio? Man, if you get a gig like this, go for it.
Yeah.
Wow. Because you never know the stuff you're going to hear. We will be right back. Hold on. I should mention this, that the voting for the American Idiot is still going on.
Right.
At WJFK.com, and there has been yet another change.
Another change in the leaderboard?
In the leaderboard.
Wow.
That the person that was in second place is now in first place.
Wow.
Okay, so you got just a couple more hours. We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show. I'm Troy McClure. You may remember me from such nature films as Earwigs, Ooh, and Man vs. Nature, The Road to Victory. In a few days, our eggs will hatch into nestlings like these over here.
They look awfully hungry, Mr. McClure.
They sure are, Billy. In nature, their mother would regurgitate food for them to eat.
That's gross.
It sure is, Billy. It sure is.
The Don and Mike Show.
Just ordinary guys with nothing to lose. Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
Let's see what's happening here. Hello.
All right.
Don and Mike Show.
Hi. Just wanted to call and say that I was going through the Penthouse magazine of this month. And you remember the phone calls you were making out of Harry Potter?
Yeah.
They're actually, I came across one of these Penthouse forums, supposed to be the best of the year or whatever, and the old guy was reading this dirty things, whatever. They're actually reading verbatim from a...
We've got a real genius on the phone.
Yeah. We've got a bright one here. What's your name, my friend?
It's Carl.
And you got to be calling from Sacramento, right?
No, sir. I'm calling from Philadelphia.
From Philly?
Yes.
Yeah, that's the joke, Carl.
So
I did not understand it. I'm sorry.
What do you mean you didn't understand it?
I thought it was curious. I thought you were, when you were reading them last night, I thought you were saying, you know, that you were cutting them off in the dirty parts, obviously.
Yeah?
Yes.
What don't you understand?
We're about to do that bit again right now. I tell you what, I'm going to leave you on
hold.
Thanks
for pulling back the curtain, though.
I'm going to leave you on hold, and we'll find out what you don't understand about it, okay?
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
All right. No. Stay right there, and we'll see if we can help walk you through this. You know, I think, Mike, what with all the stuff with Robert and the police and that guy,
yeah.
We need just a moment to chill out.
Yeah.
Bill O'Reilly... Thought for the day from Billy O'Reilly.
I'm sorry I raped that lady.
Oh, dear.
Ooh.
Wow. Yeah. Oh, my.
That was not the happiest.
That was thought. Not the best chill out I've ever heard.
That was the Bill O'Reilly thought of the day. And as Carlos from Philadelphia was indicating, yes, indeed, starting Friday, it's the brand new Harry Potter movie. And yesterday late in the show, we called the Harry Potter line.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to call it again now because you get all kinds of opportunities to hear stuff about products and the movie and,
mm-hmm.
you know, crazy promotional tie-ins. And there it's ringing right now, calling the Harry Potter hotline. Who knows when it'll be today?
You've reached the Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets special phone line. If you'd like to hear this in English, press 1. If you're Carlos and you'd like to hear it in Spanish, press 2 right now. Estupido. You've reached Harry Potter in the Chamber of Secrets. For advanced ticket information, press 1.
I don't want that.
To find out how you can get exciting Harry Potter in the Chamber of Secrets merchandise, press 2.
No.
Or to hear the new Harry Potter in the Chamber of Secrets story, press 3.
Ah, that's what I want.
The voice on the phone said, meet me in the balcony for the first matinee. Polly had always been my fantasy girl, and the idea of living out another one with her was almost too much to handle. I watched time crawl past slowly. As the hour approached, I told the boss I needed to take off. driving to the theater and wondering what was on Polly's mind caused my excitement to build. After purchasing my ticket, I went straight to the darkened balcony. The movie had started, but the balcony was empty, and I settled into a seat to wait. After a few minutes, I felt a pair of hands slide over my shoulders and felt her tongue as the tip slid up my neck, stopping only for a moment at my earlobe. I'm sorry I'm late, but this performance is worth waiting for, she said, sliding into the seat next to me. I reached to kiss her, but she pushed me back, saying, look what I brought you. Sliding her raincoat open, she revealed she was naked, except for a single black ribbon around her throat. I felt myself instantly beginning to rise. As her fingers worked loose the buttons on my jeans, she slid a hard finger deep inside.
Wow. I had to cut it off.
Yeah.
You see,
had you.
The problem is, it's Harry Potter, but the guy on the phone appears to be Harry Morgan, who played Colonel Potter on MASH.
Right. Is that how that works?
And he's not reading children's fables at all.
No,
not at all.
They're X-rated stories that sound like they could come right out of Penthouse Magazine.
And maybe they actually do. What's up with that?
Let's check in with Carlos from Philly.
Hello, Carlos.
Carlos?
Yeah.
All right, so may we answer any questions for you about this bit?
I'd rather not, actually. My daughter just came into my car.
But again, Carlos, your question, I think you could ask us a question without offending your daughter.
Yeah, no, I just came across a couple of lines that reminded me of that, and that's why I understand.
What do you think? There was some big conspiracy, Carlos?
No.
Well, what's your point?
My point was that it was I thought this guy was making these things up. I didn't know they were actually coming from somewhere.
Uh-huh.
You understand? That was all my point.
What does it matter?
It doesn't matter at all.
And Carlos, may I ask you something?
Yes, sir.
What were you doing reading letters to Penthouse?
Just, you know what you said. Just reading.
Just reading. And where is Mamacita? For the little one.
It's right next to me.
Ah,
she's right next to you?
Hey, Carlos.
So your wife is there?
Oh, no.
When I said Mamacita, that's what I meant, the baby.
He wouldn't get that either, because I really firmly believe Carlos doesn't understand anything that's going on.
No, I understand. Do you
understand what we were doing, though?
Yeah, I understand.
Well, then tell us.
Explain the bit to us.
No, explain the bit to us. I don't understand the bit, sir. I don't follow the show. I just came across when you were listening.
What?
I just thought that I didn't even
why did you call
to the air.
Why did you call, though?
Why? Because I thought it was curious. That's all.
What was curious? What was curious was the fact that you were trying to get your jerk on last night while you're reading Penthouse, and you realized, hey, I heard the same story earlier today on WYSP.
And you thought you'd be some kind of super-duper Inspector Gadget when the whole world knows that we're reading out of Penthouse magazine.
Okay.
Carlos?
Yes, sir.
Now, let me really dumb it down so even you get it. Because I think you're going to enjoy the comedy here. Are you familiar with the TV show MASH?
Yeah.
Remember MASH? It was a bunch of doctors in the war in Korea?
Yes.
All right. Do you remember the guy who was Colonel Potter on that show?
Yeah.
All right. His name is Harry Morgan. Now, my friend Mike does a dead-on impression of Harry Morgan.
How are you, Carlos?
And if you put the character that he played on MASH, his last name was Potter. And in real life, the guy's name is Harry Morgan. So if you put his real name together with the name you had on MASH, what do you get?
Yeah, Harry Potter.
No, Harry Potter.
Harry Potter. So you get Harry Potter. And who's the hottest star of books and magazines and movies for kids?
Yeah, Harry Potter.
Harry Potter. Mm-hmm. So, now, get ready to laugh, Carlos. Imagine the fun when we announce we're going to call the Harry Potter hotline, and it's actually Harry Morgan reading pornography.
Yeah, yeah, I understand.
Do you know what I hate more than just about anything in the whole wide world, Carlos? You know what that is?
What?
I hate it when we have to explain a joke, especially when it's my joke. Nothing makes me angrier.
But I love it. Sometimes I love it, especially when it has to be such a long, drawn-out explanation. And I would bet you, dollars to donuts, he still doesn't get it.
I would bet also.
Isn't it funny, Carlos?
Yeah.
Carlos?
Yeah.
All right, now explain the bit to me. Now that we've laid it out for you, explain it to me.
And you were reading pornographic things, imitating as it was Harry Potter.
Well, no, we're not really reading pornographic things because actually we have to kind of edit those things when we read them, Carlos.
We're reading?
But we're reading out of a a men's magazine.
And we're reading as if it were actually... Who's doing the reading?
Harry Potter.
Yes. Well, it's Mike, but it's Harry Potter.
Yeah.
You see that now you're laughing.
I am laughing and I'm an imbecile.
There you go.
Thank you, Carlos.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Bye bye.
Have a nice day.
You know, something tells me when we call the Harry Potter line, and we're going to call it one more time.
It might be a different story.
I bet we get a story maybe about a guy from Philly named Carlos.
Mm-hmm.
And, gosh, I hope there's an option about eating BM on the hotline this time.
Jesus Christ.
But you know what else is funny?
What?
You just got to get the mental picture of Carlos working his man last night. And all of a sudden he gets like through three paragraphs and he goes... Hey, I heard this on the radio today.
Hello, you've reached the Harry Potter in the Chamber of Secrets hotline. To get advanced ticket information, press 1. To find out all about the exciting new Harry Potter in the Chamber of Secrets merchandise, press 2. To hear today's Carlos story, press 3.
Oh, that's what I want.
I was walking down the streets of Philadelphia, minding my own business, when suddenly a man came out of an alley. He was bleeding profusely from the forehead, and he had BM all over him. He said his name was Carlos, and he was so stupid that he had accidentally walked into a wall as he was eating BM. Twice now it had happened to him, he said, and he was suffering contusions and a concussion. Well, I tapped Carlos on the shoulder and said, you should always pay attention to what you're doing when you eat that big plate of BM. Thank you, Carlos, and have a nice day. But as I said that to him, he looked at me with confused, glazed eyes, and he didn't know what was going on, but he did have BM all over his face.
I wonder if he's in this country legally.
Carlos was in this country illegally.
Ah.
That's right. He'd come across the border years ago, and one of the great problems Carlos had was understanding American humor. Oh, he could understand his native humor fine, but when he got to the States, all American comedians' jokes lost on him totally and completely, but it didn't matter because he was happy to be here where he could get all the BM he could eat.
And he sure does like working his man.
Yeah. And he loves reading Penthouse Forum and working his man day in, day out. You see, Carlos is a bit compulsive about that. He does it morning, noon, and night. Works himself raw. As a matter of fact, the entire day for Carlos consists of working his man and eating BM. That's all for the Harry Potter Chamber of Secrets hotline. Thank you, and call back soon.
Well, it's not often you get a personalized call.
Pretty amazing stuff.
Pretty nutty coincidence.
Wow.
Hello.
It's amazing.
Don and Mike show.
Hi, Don. It's Don.
Hi, Don.
And you know what? I actually got the joke the very first time you did it, and it's really funny.
Thank you. Hello, Don and Mike show.
I get joke.
Listen to
Let me just say this.
It just doesn't get any better than this.
It doesn't.
Absolutely
it doesn't.
Not.
It really doesn't. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Yo, I don't get it.
Hey, is this Bitter Ann?
All across your face in your ear hole.
Hey, there you go.
Hey, BN, what's up?
I need to talk to you, goddammit.
Why?
It sounds like a sampler.
Oh, this is not really Bitter Ann?
Huh. That's weird.
I thought it was BN.
Hey,
hello, Don and Mike.
Where's the clap detector now, losers?
Three times for the same guy today?
Yep. Yep, three times for Joey. For Joey B. Not on my show.
Yeah, I got a problem. I'm on hold with people. Don't you guys hate it when you have, you're on hold and you have the worst music ever?
Try calling our agent's office.
Oh, my God.
Our agent, like, classical masterpieces. Right. Then there's heavy classical. Then there's light classical. And then there's, you know, shoot yourself in the head classical.
And it's at such a level that you can barely hear it.
Right.
Hello. Wow, what's going on there? Hello, Don and Mike show.
And there's a guy just laughing at himself. I love that.
The guy.
He just amused at himself.
Duty, duty, duty. Don and Mike show. Hello.
Mike, Don, as a transplant from San Diego to Sacramento, I have one thing to say.
The crying guy.
Yeah. Get me out of here.
Hi.
I don't think that was the crying guy. I think it was just a guy that was depressed.
Oh, he sounded like the crying guy.
He did, at the beginning.
No, not the crying guy. Just a very depressed guy that was transplanted from San Diego.
All right.
To Sacramento.
Well, you sure do sound like the crying guy.
That's culture shock, San Diego to Sacramento.
Hello, Don. Mike's show.
Hello.
Hello.
Hey, guys. That Carlos bit just now?
Yeah.
Funniest freaking thing I've heard in probably 12 years.
Thank God for guys like Carlos.
Absolutely. Yeah.
They make the show.
I couldn't stop laughing. I almost wrecked my car.
Love Carlos. And I love the mental picture of him naked, just with a big sombrero.
And somewhere. Probably like right in the middle of the throes of ecstasy when he suddenly goes, oh, I've discovered a conspiracy.
I heard this today on WISD.
They were saying that they were making enough money. In fact, they were reading it right out of the magazine. How can I possibly achieve right now?
Hello, Dynamite.
Hey, Carlos, no funny. Me get choked. Me love you. Long, long time.
All right. Goodbye. Hi, Dynamite.
Did you ever read about a frog who dreamed of being a king and then became one? Except for the names and a few other changes. If you talk about me, the story's the same one.
What is wrong with people?
I'm New York City born and raised, but nowadays I've lost the dream to show.
It's a Neil Diamond song.
Wrong? I don't hear anything wrong.
Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hello.
Hey.
How you doing?
We're doing great, thanks.
Wonderful. Okay.
What can we do for you?
Yes. I was wondering what I could do to get my band to play on your great show.
Well, where are you from?
I'm actually from Williamstown, New Jersey, but near Philadelphia.
Near Philly.
Do we need somebody to accompany our American idiot?
You know, actually...
Yes.
We do,
that
Mike.
Was great.
Right.
We do. If you would like to donate your services, you guys could be the backup band... For our American idiot.
That would be wonderful.
You got it. What's the name of your band?
The name of the band is Son of a.
Son of a.
Like son of a bitch.
I get it. Okay. All right.
Thank you, Carlos.
All right. Hold on a second there. Don and Mike show. Lisa really get the guy's information.
Yeah.
Good for him. That's what it's about. The early bird gets the worm.
Amen.
You need the one to call the show and say that. Good idea, Mike. Yes.
That's it.
We'll use him as a backup band.
Yeah, and you know, if they can coordinate with the person that's going to be doing it, the person will have legitimate accompaniment.
Even better. Just like some pickup house band.
Yeah, it'd be fantastic.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Hey, Don.
Yeah, hi.
How you doing?
Okay.
From East to Shore.
Hi,
dude. The Carlos bit was great, man.
Yeah, I'm telling you, Carlos made that. I know you were mad about that at first, Mike, but I'm telling you, Carlos made that happen.
Oh, no, don't get me wrong. I'm still mad about it.
And the other thing.
Yeah.
You guys almost killed me the other night with that vagina monologue. I die when a girl is screaming about the cobwebs.
Yeah, you can have that every day on the show.
And let me just say, let's wait until tomorrow when it's the scrotal monologue.
Ah!
Just wait. All right, see you later. Hold on. Where are you from? The Eastern Shore?
Eastern Shore.
Yes, I like throwing out prompts to 96 Rock.
Dude, I'm listening to you on JFK. Can you believe it?
Oh, the Baltimore station?
Yeah, I can get it all the way down here.
Yeah, enjoy that. They'll take us off in about 3 minutes. We'll see you later.
See you later.
All right. Peace out.
Very good. I like it.
Goodbye. All right. Thank you for the calls. Mike, you and I getting away for a relaxing weekend in Atlantic City.
Yes, very much so.
In just a couple of weeks. We both love the blackjack.
We do enjoy that.
We crave the blackjack.
We got the expert here.
He's here.
Oh, man, I'm excited. I want him to give our listeners information, but I want us to give...
Yeah.
I want secret information, yeah, too.
Stuff for me and you. Yeah. So we're both big winners.
Go down and lose our ass.
In Atlantic City. George Papadopoulos.
Good Greek.
Blackjack Master coming right up. And continue, please, to go to WJFK.com to vote for your American Idiot favorite. Right now, up. The lead has changed again.
My God, this is topsy-turvy.
The lead has changed again.
Cool.
One person has 28%. The second place person now, it's starting, the margin is starting to widen. 28%. I didn't do that for comedic effect. 28% to 22%. Perhaps I did that because I knew I was going to say this. Manassas. This is Broadway's Don Geronimo, here to announce the return of Mike O'Meara and the Crap Blues Band to Brady's in Manassas, Virginia. The fun starts Saturday night. Check it out and see why I'm now choreographing the entire stage show.
Cool.
The Saturday night music, fun, and my exhilarating dance numbers at Brady's in Manassas.
This Saturday night, that's right.
What did I say?
The Saturday night.
Read it yourself then. I'm doing the best I can.
I know, and I appreciate that.
This Saturday night.
I know. You know, if I read it, I read it every break.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Yeah, hey, I got a message for Carlos.
And look at the product placement, Mike.
I know. It's right prime time. You know how I love that.
Prime time. Hello.
Carlos, essay. Lay off the BM burritos, brother.
All right. Hello, Don and Mike.
Yeah. Well, that wasn't me.
Oh, no.
Here's the real crying guy.
Yeah.
Hi, crying guy.
Yeah, no, I don't live in Sacramento, Don.
I know. Sorry.
Are we going to have a website?
Yeah, very soon it's going to be DonandMikeWebsite.com.
Yeah, but is it going to be good, though?
Yeah, it's going to be fantastic.
Okay.
We'll be fine, crying guy.
All right, crying guy.
I just want to, Mike...
Yeah, crying.
I've been really worried about you, man.
Really? Why is that?
Well, you keep like hitting that stuff, and I just want you to know I'm with you, man.
Thank you. Don't get upset. It's going to be fine.
You,
it's going to be okay, brother.
All right, crying
love
guy.
You, man.
Nah, thank you. I love you, too.
Okay, bye.
Yes, crying guy.
Can I buy a Taiwan basket?
Absolutely. If it'll cheer you up.
Thanks, bye.
You bet. There he goes.
Don't you always end this, though, by asking Buzz for weed?
He's too upset, I think.
Aren't you going to ask Buzz for some weed?
We want the payoff.
Hello?
He's changing the bet.
Thanks for laughing at him.
He asked him for a basket this time.
Yeah.
He's keeping it fresh.
Yeah.
Ask him for some weed. Come on.
You got any weed?
Yeah. Yes, I do.
Okay, we'll be right back. Thank you.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
So how long do I wait to call?
A day.
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow, then a day.
Yeah. So 2 days.
Yeah, I guess you could call it that.
Definitely.
2 days.
2 days is like industry standard. No, I used to wait 2 days to call anybody, but now it's like everyone in town waits 2 days. So I think 3 days is kind of money. What do you think?
Yeah, well, but two's enough not to look anxious.
Yeah, two's enough not to look anxious, but I think 3 days is kind of money.
Yeah,
you know?
But you know what? Maybe I'll wait 3 weeks.
How's that? And tell her I was cleaning out my wallet and I just happened to run into her number.
Then ask her where you met her.
Yeah, I'll ask her where I met her. I don't remember. What does she look like? And then I'll ask if we f***ed. Would that be the money?
The Don and Mike Show. How's your tank? The Don and Mike Show.
Bring it, George. Let me tell you that we've had another astounding change on WJFK.com as we move into the last hour of voting for the American Idiot.
Have the places changed again?
No. But the person who's leading now has a wider lead.
Really? Oh, so it looks like you might have a clear winner. Is this person lapping the field?
Yeah, it's a two-horse race. It's Janet and Dave in no particular order.
Wow.
I will tell you, one of them has 16,000 votes, and the other one has 13,000 votes.
Excellent.
And I think it's an upset in the making.
Really?
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Joining us now.
Yeah, let's talk gambling.
Yeah, gambling.
Our man, hey, baby.
George. Now, say your last name right.
Papadopoulos.
Papadopoulos
is a very common Greek name.
That's like Smith or Jones.
Absolutely. I know the Greeks. I love the Greeks.
George Papadopoulos, his website, blackjacknocounting.com. George, you've written a book about blackjack, how to win without counting, and as it turns out, Mike and I, by coincidence, are going to Atlantic City in 2 weeks.
Oh, absolutely. Well, you got to look me up.
And we...
Is that where you hang out? Is that where you live down there?
I live about 20 minutes outside of Atlantic City.
Hey, we could sit at the same table with this guy. Or do they let you sit at tables?
Yeah.
They don't know you and, like, see you come in and go, here.
They don't care. I'm not a card counter.
Okay. All right. And that's the bottom line.
So if you're not a card counter, how do you win a blackjack?
I win 78% of the time without counting cards. There's five basic rules that you must know. Bankroll, basic strategy, money management, table trends, and discipline. That's all you need
Rob,
to know.
Get the cards.
Where are the books? Do we have the books?
Here are the books.
Because I'm going to be studying.
I'm going to give you the book after we're done with the interview.
All right.
Because right now, I want to just play and see if he beats us.
All right, very good. Very good.
Can we do that? Because Mike and I are just a couple of mooks.
Yeah, I mean, I have done well.
Dumb as a box of rocks.
The only time I've really done well is when, you know, it's like anything else, when you practice. Like, when you get on one of those computer games. And I think it's great for gamblers that they have those computer games. So you can kind of get it together. And, you know, if you have a strategy like you do,
hey, Robbie,
you can work it out. And that's when I've done well.
Why don't you be the dealer and you can be the
house? Not only that, but you can see if it's working, if it's not working.
Right.
You know, I mean, there's 178 books out there on blackjack. Well, they don't all work.
We'll let our friend Rob be the dealer and be the house. That means house has to stick on 16, right?
No, 17.
Oh, it's 17.
See, already
17.
You're learning.
All right,
17.
You knew that.
Well, don't look at me. I thought...
No, you knew that.
I thought we'd been to Reno, and at one place in Reno, the house had to stick on 16.
No, 17. But it was a test, I know. It was a test.
Okay, all right, so I didn't know that.
Well, don't get defensive about it. Calm down.
You looked at me like I was an idiot.
Well, you've looked at me like I'm an idiot for 18 years.
Okay. All right. Shuffle them up, Robbie.
All right.
Now, George, before we play this hand, can you tell us some of the strategy that you will use to beat Mike and I?
Okay. Now, am I going to be the dealer?
No, I am.
Robbie is the dealer, and Robbie will be the house.
We're going to play like three of us are sitting at the table. Is that the way? You tell us the best way. You've obviously done this before. What's the best way to play this in the studio to demonstrate your technique?
Okay, well, we're all playing against the dealer, all of us.
Against Robbie.
So we're not playing against each other.
We're not playing against each other. We're playing against Robbie.
Yeah. So what we'll do is we'll sit down here, and we'll deal out the cards. And then you make a decision saying, I think I'll hit or I'll stick. And
right.
I'll
you want to deal all the cards up so you can kind of analyze what we're doing here?
Well, do it. No, the dealer has to have one card down and one
up.
Okay,
one card down and
but
one
we
card
have,
up.
We all have the cards up.
Okay.
You make a decision, say, like Don would say, I think I'll hit. And I'll say, I think
all right. That's, you know,
this way I'll coach you with what I think you should do.
Fantastic. Right. Deal them out, Robbie.
All right, I'm going to waive the cut.
All right.
Mike is showing 9, Don a 6. Our guest of 5. Mike showing 19.
It's easy.
Don showing 14. Our guest showing 6 or 16.
No, he's supposed to put his second card down.
Well, no, they're all up right now, Mike. Our cards are all up.
He can analyze.
Oh, but you're the dealer. Okay, right. I'm sorry. I apologize.
And the dealer is showing
Mike.
King.
Mike. It's my chance to look at you like you're an idiot.
Okay.
So, Rob, you have what?
The dealer is showing 10, a king of spades.
All right. Now, Mike, you have...
Fine. I have 19, and I will stick.
That's correct.
This, for me, is a perfect... Rob, you're showing what?
I'm showing 10.
I would think I got to take a hit on 14.
You have to.
All right. So, give me a hit.
16.
Now... This happens to me all the time.
Now, I would say, George, I would say he has to take a hit on that also.
Absolutely. You must.
I must take a hit.
The chances of you, I'll tell you what the odds are. The chances of you busting are 66% that you're going to break.
All right.
However, if you stand with that, the odds are 74% that you're going to lose.
I can't wait. I'm going to memorize your book.
I'm going to go against your advice.
You're going to stay.
Yeah, that's cool.
I'm going to stay at 16.
All right, let's see what happens. That's cool.
Stay at 16. And George has...
Six or 16.
This is what you call a soft 16. Anything with an ace is a soft hand.
Okay.
So I will hit.
All right.
Ace has... So now he has 7.
I have 13.
Right.
13.
I will hit that.
And great. 23, you're busted.
All right. Now, Don, what did you end up with?
16.
All right. And, Rob, you turn your car over.
Don would have also busted had you followed the advice. 20.
Rob has 20.
So dealer wins and we
dealer
all lose.
Dealer wins. We all lose.
But the odds were, with that hand that Rob had, everybody was going to lose anyway at the table.
Yeah, that's what the odds are. You should hit on that hard 16, though, but you're going to break most of the time.
When you talk about bankroll, and I've heard that before, it's the way you bet is extremely significant. Is that correct?
That's correct, but that's not bankroll.
Okay, Mike. What's bankroll?
Bankroll is it tells you how much money to bring to the casino and how much money you should expect to win with the bankroll that you're bringing.
All right, let's say you're a guy like me, not a big spender. I'm going to go with, let's say, $500.
Okay.
Now, is that too small potatoes for you to help with?
Well, here's what the rule is. You need 40 times the table minimum in order to play at that table. So let's say you're playing at a $5 table. You need $200.
Okay.
A $10 table, you need $400. A $25 table, you need $1,000.
Okay.
Now, you want to bring $500, let's say it's called $600. You can stay at a $15 table. You're okay. That's 40 times the table minimum. You need a win goal and a loss limit. Very, very important.
All right, so what is the loss? This is what I need to know.
All right.
What's the loss limit?
The loss limit is your entire gambling bankroll. That's your loss limit.
Mm-hmm.
Your win goal is 50% of your gambling bankroll.
So if I started with $600 and I won $300, that's when I should walk away?
You're done.
I walk
You're done.
Away.
You walk away.
Now, so once you get up to, and if it's 10 minutes and he gets up 300, he walks away, that's it. He's done playing for the day.
Thank God. You should say a prayer. You do it 10 minutes.
But now, George, how long do you walk away for? Do you walk away long enough to go have dinner, have a drink, have a smoke, or do you walk away for 12 hours? How long do you walk away?
3 hours.
3 hours.
3 hours, you get out of the casino.
So cool.
Go get something to eat. Go catch a show.
Right.
Take a walk. See the sights. If you're in Vegas, for example, there's so many things you can do. Go to sleep if you want. You know, take a shower. Get up and put on new clothes. But stay out of the casino. Now, when you come back into the casino, you're starting again. It's called sessions. I have that in my second book. You're starting all over again. You won your $300. Now, here's a suggestion also. You live here in Virginia. You're going to Las Vegas. You're going to be in Vegas for 3 days, okay? Now, you've just played a session and you won. Bring an envelope with a stamp on there. Get that $300, go to the cashier, get a check. Put the check in the envelope. Send it home. Send it, seriously.
Don't have access to your cash.
Exactly. Send it to yourself. Send it home. That's one session money gone. Now, remember,
but meanwhile, you still got your initial bankroll.
$600.
Exactly. See, what you need...
That's a wonderful strategy, really.
What you need, for example, you go to Vegas, and Don, you tell me, that George, I want to go to Vegas, I want to play at a $5 table, I want to play twice a day, and I'm going to be there 3 days. How much money do I bring? Okay. You're going to be there, you want to play twice a day. Okay, so we already discussed that you need $200 at a $5 table, or 40 times the table minimum.
Right.
Every table. Okay, so that's $200 and $200. That's $400 a day. So you need $1,200 as your gambling bankroll.
For 3 days, right.
For three full days. Okay, bring yourself some envelopes. Okay, now, the first day you're there, bang, you hit them in 10 minutes, and you won. So you won.
But the rest of the day you hang out.
Well, not the rest. Take 3 hours off.
3 hours off.
Yeah. Take 3 hours, go out, go to, some of these things.
But when you come back after 3 hours, you don't let that bankroll go for the day.
Right, exactly. That bankroll is gone. Like, you never had it. That's why I suggest bring an envelope, put it in the mail, send it home. Because you're not supposed to know you had that. Now you have another bankroll, fresh bankroll. There you go again. And this time, well, Don, it might take you 15 minutes. I don't want that to upset you now.
Now, George, how often when you play, do you win?
78% of the time. And when I say 78, here's what I mean. I don't mean I walk in there and I win a dollar and I say I'm a winner. I mean I win 50% of my gambling bankroll 78% of the time. So 78...
Wow. Basically, 8 out of 10 times you're playing.
Oh, but just about. Yeah,
right.
Just about.
What's the biggest amount of money you've ever won?
Okay.
When you were on one streak, one hand, whatever it was, one night, what's the biggest bankroll you ever won?
The biggest bankroll that I've ever won. Now, remember, I don't go there to win a lot of money all the time. I went to win consistently. I won $8,000 was my biggest. I sit at the $100 table.
So what does that mean? $100 table, I say you need 40 times the table minimum.
You,
I need
four grand. You got four grand to sit at the
four
table.
Four grand, I'm looking to win two. That's all I'm looking to win. $2,000.
And then you walk away.
I walk away. I come back tomorrow. This is what I'm saying. You need to be consistent. I mean, you know, I'll tell you what. Somebody who's never played blackjack in their life can sit down at a blackjack table and win the, right. for the first hour. But I guarantee he's not going to keep that.
The most difficult thing about your strategy, I would imagine, would be you're sitting down there and you're winning.
Right.
And you got to leave when you're winning. It's got to be, but if it's 3 hours, you can come back. And it's got to be a very good way to do it, I would say. It sounds like a very intelligent system.
It's a great feeling because, you know, it's like Monopoly money. When you're playing there, they got these chips. It's not real money.
Right.
I mean, when you walk outside that door, bang, it hits you. Somebody says, you know, I have a cup of coffee. That's $1. Oh, $1. Wow, I'm sitting here playing $100 chips and $1 for a cup. You know, everything comes back to reality because that's Disneyland. And that's why they do it. They don't have any windows. They don't have any clocks.
I got another question for you. You're talking about this and you bring a certain bankroll. What kind of bankroll and how much gambling do you have to do for pit bosses and dealers to notice you so you can get free stuff? The comps that they give away in these casinos. How much do you have? You hear about whales all the time and how much they gamble, but how much does the average guy who doesn't have a lot of money, how much does he have to gamble to get spiffed? Is there a system to that, too?
Okay. Normally, at a $25 table, they'll notice you at a $25 table. At a $10 table, they'll notice you if you start winning a lot, you know, but it's like so-so. What I suggest, and I tell people, go to gamble to win money. Don't go to gamble for comps. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, take whatever they give you.
Right.
You know?
But don't think about it.
No, right. I mean, you know what they'll tell you? I hear it all the time. They'll say, this guy will say, you know, I want to get something neat. Can I have a comp? Yeah, hold on. Why don't you play it a little longer? I seen a guy do that the other day. He lost $500.
Yeah,
the guy came back with a $40 comp.
That's what it's all about.
Let's play another hand. Let me give you a plug here. The book is Blackjack's Hidden Secrets, Win Without Counting. The website is blackjacknocounting.com.
I like the logic of it. I like the simplicity.
All right, deal them out. Deal them out, Robbie.
Mike has an ace. Don has a queen. Our guest has a 10. Mike, 4 or 14. I'm sorry. I deal them all.
Yeah, you deal them up.
20 for Don, 20 for the dealer, for our guest, and showing an ace.
Wow. Okay, now
the dealer is showing an ace.
Okay, what the dealer has to do now, normally, and
he's going to do insurance.
Casinos, yes, he'll ask if anybody wants insurance. Do you want insurance?
No, I don't.
I don't either.
Good. You should never, ever take insurance. I don't care if you have blackjack. Don't take insurance.
Why?
Because the odds of a dealer, the odds of him having a 10-value card under there are 3 1/3 to 1 against him. Remember, there's 13 denominations in the deck. You got 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, jack, queen, king, ace. Okay, he can only get, there's only 4, 10, a jack, a queen, or a king. That'll give him blackjack. So 4 into 13 is 3 1/3 odds against him having a blackjack.
Mathematically, the odds are against him having a blackjack.
All right. If they weren't, the casinos wouldn't be saying, you want insurance?
Right.
You know? They would never say that.
Exactly. All right, so let's go around then. Mike, what do you got?
At this point, don't I have to check?
At this point, check, but don't tell anybody unless you have blackjack.
All right, Mike, what do you have?
I have 414, and I have to take a hit on that, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, all right, 414.
9.
And what is that?
13.
13, I got to take a hit.
23.
And I break.
Okay.
All right. And that was the right play, though, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah,
you made the right
play. I have 20, and I'm sticking.
Okay, yeah. And I have 20, and I'm sticking.
Right. Let's see what the dealer has. Dealer
16.
Has 16.
16. 16.
Hmm. 17.
17, he must stay.
He must stay.
He's got
you both
17.
Win.
So I'm the winner. And George is the winner.
Right. Exactly. Now,
we're going to have some fun, aren't we?
We are.
You know, what do you do? Say you're going down with a buddy of yours to Atlantic City, and you're planning on probably hanging out at the same table and hanging out. But you're both extremely competitive. How do you make it through that weekend?
Okay.
Because, listen, here's our dilemma.
We're going to probably want to play at the same
time. Yeah, we want to play together.
We gamble differently, though.
Right.
We do.
We want to play together.
I have no restrictions anymore.
But I want him to win
as
much as I want me to win.
Is it better for us to go to separate tables or to stay at the same table?
Okay, you can both. It's actually better to go to separate tables.
Okay.
Because the interaction's not going to be there. You're not going to be watching him. He's not going to be watching you.
Right.
Things like that. Sometimes that has a play. Also, even if you start at the same tables. Let's say you got
Don and Mike both go down, sit down at the same tables, put down the exact same amount of money and everything else. And Don's doing great. And Mike is getting killed over here, okay? Just lost four hands in a row. Book says, you lose four hands in a row, you leave that table. Go to another table. I'm not saying leave the casino. I'm saying leave that table.
Even if you're not busting your bankroll, if you lose four hands in a row, you leave the table.
You absolutely do. Even if you've been winning like crazy, even if you've been winning and you say, oh, man, okay, now I lost, boom, 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 boom. The trend is not in your favor. It's changed. It's changed to the dealer's favor. Leave that table. Go to another table. I mean, I can tell you, I go to sometimes five, six, seven tables. I mean, I don't even lose four hands in a row. I'll lose two or three, and I'll say, you know, things
are going. You get a feeling, and you follow your gut.
Absolutely.
Right. Mike, listen, read the book and memorize it before we go to Atlanta.
I will.
Let's play one more hand, and we got a break.
All right, here we go.
Hey, I love the logic.
Wait till I get you guys
thing.
Down there.
Let you know when we're coming down. Let me ask you one last question.
Huh?
What do you do if you just, you're two guys with a radio show, and you just can't seem to get a goddamn room in Atlantic City on Thanksgiving weekend? How the hell do you do that?
Thanksgiving weekend is rough. Now, if you were telling me the Tuesday, Monday, Wednesday, Thursday.
Somebody can help us.
Okay. All right, Robbie, go ahead and deal them. What do you got?
A two for Mike. Don with the King of Spades. Mr. Papadopoulos with a Jack. Mike showing 10. Don showing 13. Mr. Papadopoulos with a pair of jacks, and dealer shows 4.
All right, you've got what?
I will, a 10, and I will double down.
There you go. Absolutely. Correct move.
Thank you very much.
14.
That's okay. That's all right.
All right, now I got to stay on that 14.
Yes, you only get one card.
I have 13. I'll take a hit.
Oh, wait. 13. I suggest you don't take a hit.
He's showing
a 4. Oh. He's showing a 4. He's got a breaking card. You should not hit a 13 against a 4.
I will take your advice. I'll stick on 13.
All right.
I stay.
All right. Dealer has 4, 6, 16, 24. Dealer bust.
Bam. There you go.
Bad. Right there.
Hey, George, you know what? That's pretty good advice. If I hadn't heard that from you, I swear to God I would have hit on that 13.
Is, you know, a lot of people that, and that's a problem also.
That's pretty good.
When you sit down at a table with somebody who has absolutely no idea about how to play. Do you get out of that situation, too? If you've got some old lady that's to your right that has never played before, she's taking a hit on a hard 17?
Okay, Mike, to me, it doesn't bother me at all. It's all psychological. What I tell people, if it bothers you, leave the table. You should be comfortable when you sit and play. You should be comfortable. So if other people bother you, leave the table. But I will tell you, mathematically, it doesn't make any difference.
Doesn't make at all.
No difference at all. For as many times that person took your card and made you break, same amount of times he's going to take your card and make you win.
Okay.
Great. All right. George Papadopoulos, the book, Blackjack's Hidden Secrets, Win Without Counting, blackjacknocounting.com. We will call you when we go to Atlantic City.
Please do.
Absolutely. Pleasure having you on the show.
Thank you very much.
You got to get out of here.
Thank you, George. Thank you very much.
Very nice meeting you.
That is really, really interesting.
Pretty interesting stuff.
I like it. I think that's fun.
Nice meeting you.
What's that yet?
Give me a call. I'm there.
All right. We'll get your number. I swear to God.
We'll call him up.
Take him out to dinner.
Are you kidding?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I'll bring him to the table with me. I'm not beyond having a coach.
That'll be fine.
No, they don't care either.
That's right. The only thing they hate is counting.
All right, thanks, George.
Bye-bye.
That's cool.
But how many points for a king?
He looks like a gambler, too, doesn't he?
Here, Buzz.
What's that?
Buzz just sneaked in. How many points for a king?
He never said.
He never
Buzz
said.
Buzz is
10. Thank you.
10, Buzz. 10. Great. Great segment. Great guest.
Yeah.
Boy, do I wish it was Thanksgiving already.
Yeah, I'm excited now. And, you know, it really, this kind of stuff is helpful. You know, learning the strategies and stuff. You know what? Really, what I recommend for you two, if you haven't played in a while,
right.
It's really good to, they have computer programs now where you can actually, the basic strategy of, like, the, you know, hitting on a hard 14 or something like that, you can actually buy computer programs that will say, no, that's not the way to play it.
Great games for PS2 as well. Golden Nugget is a lot of fun. It's got all the games.
That's a great way to gear up and practice.
You know, one thing I would bet anything on that you and I would never do?
What's that?
Is that move about bring a stamp envelope?
No.
Put the money in the envelope and send it home?
You know, hey, didn't he say discipline?
Yeah.
I have none.
You'll be hit on 4 for 5,
though. Is the Don and Mike Show.
Be right back.
Listen, my friend, I am a supporter of the gay community. I wore a red ribbon to the Emmys. I have been to several Elton John concerts.
What does that mean?
Elton John is a gay.
The Don and Mike Show.
Well, now you see, this is funny, because here's the guy.
from Larry Sanders.
This is Scott Thompson saying Don and Mike are a gay.
Right.
Wishing ye good luck in everything. Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
So what do you think? Do we hook up with George in Atlantic City?
George's probably a lot of fun.
Yeah, he was
I wonder if he'd be fun if the tables were out of the tables.
He was serious about wanting to get together with us. Yeah. Yes, sir. We'll do it. You think you can make us some money.
Very good.
All right, just ahead of Buzz's new show, it's Wednesday. We know what that means. Now, neither Mike nor I have pre-read this. Rob says, what do you say about it? How many stars do you give it this week?
I'll give it 3 stars. He's on the right track.
All right, it's time for from USA Today. The final word.
I'm Craig Wilson. For some moms, home is not at the range. With Thanksgiving only a couple of weeks off, our thoughts once again turn toward the kitchen.
Despite what everyone says about it being the center of every home and the fact that we Americans spend $40,000 on average remodeling them, the only time I'm really pleased about being there is when I'm at someone else's house. It's a party, and I have a glass of wine in my hand.
Otherwise, I'm happy to leave the land of granite counters and sub-zeros to someone else.
Blame it on my childhood. I grew up in a home where the kitchen was the room you went through to get out of the house. We ate there on occasion, if I remember correctly, but that was about it.
Though she can whip up a mean pan of scalloped potatoes, my mother was never mistaken for Julia's child.
I love what he talks about his mother.
Mm-hmm. The kitchen was not her turf. In fact, if she was halfway through getting supper ready and the phone rang with someone offering up a dinner invitation, we were all out the door quicker than you could say, Stouffer's.
And today's trend of sitting at the chef's table at a fancy restaurant completely mystifies her. I mean, you're in the kitchen. You go out to get out of the kitchen.
Fine dining for her remained a baked potato from the toaster oven, eaten on a TV tray in front of the news.
Extra butter, please.
Most of Mom's friends come from the same cookie cutter. Not that they ever used one. Call them Mother's Allergic to Kitchen, or MAK for short. Their numbers are legion. You probably know one.
Frankie, for instance, never knew what she was going to serve her family before she saw them coming through the door. But whatever she threw together, she hoped was enough to last a few evenings. She called them scraps, not leftovers. And for some reason, I found that rather exotic. Probably because I never had to eat them.
And then there was Corinne, who stored cat food in her oven. Kept it dry, she said.
I theorize my partner, Jack.
Winner.
I theorize my partner, Jack, became such a good cook only to counteract his mother's cooking all those years ago back in Trenton. Family legend has it, she thought she'd died and gone to heaven when mashed potatoes began arriving in a box.
These were all women who found the kitchen a necessity, not a luxury. They would not be impressed by today's gourmet centers with their Viking stoves and walk-in freezers. If they were going to walk into anything, it would be a closet full of handbags and shoes.
So when I hear friends wax on about their aroma-filled childhood...
Oh, hold on. Reset.
Hold on, we have to get it back.
Well, there have been lots of things in today's.
Continuing now, the final word.
I'm Craig Wilson.
So when I hear friends wax on about their aroma-filled childhoods spent sitting around the kitchen watching their mothers cook all day long...
How queer is that? Really, how queer is that?
I only want to ask whether they didn't have anything better to do. Wasn't there shopping to be done?
Dogs to walk? Martinis to be stirred?
I was reminded of all this the other night when I was over to my neighbor Mary's for drinks.
Quite proud of herself. She has bought hors d'oeuvres at Trader Joe's, that California grocery chain all my mother's friends would have loved, because a lot of Joe's offerings need only to be heated up.
There was only one problem. Mary didn't know how to turn on her oven.
Felt right at home.
Oh,
excellent. So many stars this week. You got, of course, my partner Jack.
Yeah, fantastic. Storing cat food in the oven.
Closet full of handbags and shoes. Wasn't there shopping to be done?
My favorite.
Dogs to walk.
Oh, my God.
Hey, he's hunting it up. He's refining it.
My mother was never mistaken for Julia Child. He's just killing him, too.
You can't go wrong when he's mentioning Mom and Jack in the same column.
Way to go, Craig. You didn't let us down.
Thank you, Craig. And now...
In a world where owning a radio was strictly forbidden...
Let's go that way.
One man found a way to bring good news to his people.
Buzz.
That's me.
He made it up.
And Buzz, your lead story today.
Today, England has more than one queen in the royal palace.
All right. Stay tuned.
Stay tuned.
Stay
for
tuned.
For news and comments.
News and comments.
Coming up
coming
on
up.
The Don and Mike
Don
Show.
Don and Mike Show. That was very...
professional.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
What's the word? Planet Crack Bar.
The Don and Mike Show. The Don and Mike Show.
What?
The Don and Mike Show.
Anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe.
All right, introduce Buzz.
The Bear Down Chicago Bears and the Green Bay Packers in the Super Bowl 35 on the frozen tundra of Lando Field. For the Bears, it's down their last ditch effort. Fourth down and goal. They're at the 8-yard line. To Buzz Burbank. Breaks the tackle at the line of scrimmage. He's at the 5. Sheds the tackle at the 2. Touchdown, Buzz Burbank. And the Bears have won the world championship.
Oh, yeah. Time for Buzz's new show brought to you tonight. The Duramax Sexual Enhancer. Has great sex more often.
Yes, please.
With Duramax, find our health food stores, pharmacies, retailers everywhere. Call 1-888-TRY-VMAX. It was brought to my attention. We were going to announce the American Idiot winner now. However, the show gets played in some markets like Little Rock, Arkansas. Tape delayed, late night broadcast.
So we're going to wait till tomorrow?
Yep. So the polls will be open until whenever the show ends airing tonight.
Okay.
Around America.
I see.
And we'll have the winner for you tomorrow.
Very good.
Website, WJFK.com, to vote for the American Idiot. And now, Buzz.
Hi, Donna Mike. Prince Charles says there'll be an investigation into charges that a male servant in the palace raped another male servant.
Hello?
There's also been talk of videotape of the victim talking about this.
I was unjustly subdued.
Hello, you asked for it, bitch.
Well, you should know one thing, that I will forever be yours.
The search for this tape, which may or may not exist, will also be part of the internal investigation.
I remember what you said. As you bent me over, you said...
It just doesn't get any better than this.
Yes, Sir Huff. The servant who allegedly committed the rape worked directly for Prince Charles. The alleged victim worked elsewhere in the British Royal Palace.
Send me my manservant, please.
What is... He's having sex with... Blams!
Charges that Princess Di's ex-butler stole from the palace were dropped after the queen suddenly remembered the butler told her he was holding those items for safekeeping.
Send me my manservant, please.
And now I remember.
I wish to speak with my manservant.
The guy who created Spider-Man, the Hulk, and other superheroes is suing his old comic book company.
Yes. I'm for Stan Lee on this, Buzz.
Sure.
I really am, that he's really gotten shafted by Marvel Comics. Mm-hmm.
He's never been the same since his son passed away, though.
Who?
Bruce. Stan Lee wants $10 million from Marvel, accusing it of cheating him out of millions of dollars in movie profits.
His daughter, Sandra.
Yeah.
Well, no, that's Sandra D, sorry.
Not Lee. And left with, the brother that never really amounted to anything.
What's that?
Fee.
That's one that only you and I know.
I'm sorry. I am inside. He says he was supposed to get 10% of the profits from his characters' movies and TV shows. Stan Lee says Marvel's told him that despite the millions raked in by the Spider-Man movie, there are no profits as defined in its contract with him.
Now listen to this.
Yeah.
Not only did the Spider-Man movie make over $400 million,
wow,
but in the first weekend it was out on DVD,
yeah,
made $200 million.
Incredible.
And I was actually at one point sitting around, you know, fascinated by this story, doing the math in my head, thinking, how much do you think, once they get past all the cost of the movie and everything,
right,
the DVD, to print the thing on a DVD, mm-hmm, and to slap the sticker on the box, it's got to cost them what?
$4. $3
tops.
Maybe.
Tops.
Yeah, two, three.
They're charging $25 a pop,
mm-hmm,
and they sold 11 million copies,
oh my God,
in 3 days. They made in 3 days, mm-hmm, half of what they made from the movie being in the theater.
Right.
For 6 months.
And it's incredible. And, I mean, and young and old. My daughter, Catherine, her absolute favorite. And they're telling Stan Lee, no profits for you.
Yeah, and just give him some money.
Publicly, Marvel says it's done nothing wrong and that Stan Lee is still well compensated for his contribution.
Well, I happen to know, I read a book about this, that Marvel went through an ownership change.
Right.
Ron Perlman bought them, the guy from Revlon Perfume.
Ah.
And Stan Lee's deal is he gets $1 million a year.
Mm-hmm.
From Marvel Comics, no matter what. And the problem is, he signed that deal when Marvel stock was trading, I think, for under $1 a share. Anyway.
Poor guy. Not fair. Funk's...
Well, now, are you mocking me for my...
No.
Yes, you are.
Your passion?
For my passion for Stan Lee?
Yeah.
I know you're just sitting there looking down, and I looked at you...
Stan Lee.
For Stan Lee.
Being screwed by the man. The guy, you know? He's given so much of himself.
He has. It's web-slinging time.
I understand.
It's your friendly neighborhood Spider-Man.
Hey, my daughter was Spider-Man for Halloween, so I'm tracking with you with the Spider-Man. Funk singer Rick James is making a comeback as an alleged sex offender.
Uh-oh.
He was convicted in 93 of assaulting two women and was sentenced to 2 years in prison back then. Now at age 50, he's under investigation in Los Angeles for sexual assault of another woman.
Yeah.
The 26-year-old woman says it happened at Rick's house. That isn't Rick James, is it?
Yeah.
Quoting a cop, they are allegations of a sexual nature.
Oh, no.
Rick James had the super hit Freak in 1981. Super Freak was his hit in 1981. He tried a career comeback in 97, but having a stroke like I did left him unable to go on tour.
And then Rick
She's
James,
a very freaky girl!
And then he said,
it just doesn't get any better than this.
You're right, Rick.
Thank you!
Hey, it works for dead painters and singers, so will it work with a dead comedian? Turns out the late Phil Hartman recorded nearly 24 comedy skits about 25 years ago.
I'm doing these from the grave, Dave.
His brother has just found them and put them for sale on the internet.
It's a drawn-on casket, Dave.
It's creepy, Buzz.
The brother says these are unique because they're the only comedy routines Phil Hartman wrote and performed all by himself.
Sure they are.
One bit features the Sphincters, a San Fernando Valley family similar to The Simpsons, a show that later featured Phil Hartman. The brother says part of the royalties will go to Phil's kids.
Woo-hoo, man! That's cold!
Not as cold as my cold dead corpse.
Bob Hope, speaking of, maybe getting a permanent thank you for all those USO shows.
And Bob, here it is. Look, it's a beautiful casket.
That's beautiful.
Hope entertained American soldiers for years. Now, a San Diego group called Taffy 3 is sponsoring a military tribute that would feature 5 full-sized bronze statues of
Taffy,
Bob.
Taffy, another thing I can't chew, baby.
The statues...
Wow!
Statues would be unveiled on Hope's 100th birthday, which is coming around next May.
I'm going to be 100 years old.
And the statues will cost $10
million. $10 million, who the hell cares? Keep me alive.
That is big. The Iraqi government has accepted the UN plan for tougher weapons inspections.
Yeah, they're lying, baby.
Officials in Iraq say they don't like the plan, but they accept in the interest of avoiding war.
Oh, we're still playing this for Bob Hope.
It's my theme song. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Bob Hope inviting you to join me for Bob Hope's Christmas in the Cemetery. Join me as the AP All-America football team throws the last bit of dirt on my coffin. Wild, yeah, wild. Isn't that wild? Yeah, wild. I'm having steak for dinner. Drink up.
So Iraq has accepted the UN plan. Saddam Hussein's government answered the United Nations 2 days ahead of the deadline, but it still has to cooperate with the inspectors if it hopes to avoid being attacked.
Can't see the troops with these little bunny eyes of mine.
By the U.S. and its allies.
I'm watching this thing on TV today,
right.
And I see that they're showing pictures like of the palaces.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And what they're saying on TV is all he has to do is move the weapons from this palace.
Right.
To this palace.
Right.
No wonder he's agreed to this so quickly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and what's weird, though, is the parliament coming out and saying we're totally against this, and then they accept it.
That was his attitude.
I mean, it's just such BS. Yeah.
They must have talked to George Clinton. Parliament.
Parliament. Yeah. Ann Wilson of Heart has lost 55 pounds since January. Before that, she was 100 pounds overweight.
Mm.
But in January, surgeons put a band around her stomach, giving it an hourglass shape so she'd feel full faster. This is different than Al Roker's gastric bypass surgery.
Incredible!
Quoting Anne, my problem was portion control. No relation to Wilson Phillips singer Carney Wilson, who also had surgery to lose 150 pounds. And Ann says there is no truth to the rumor.
Oh, this is so great.
That cruel concert goers used to throw donuts at her while she was on stage.
How great. Wow. How great is that? He said, hey, dude, I'm going to go see Heart tonight. Come on, we got to stop at Krispy Kreme.
Time to make the donuts. The four major TV networks are talking about boycotting the Emmy Awards next year and about having an award show of their own. They're angry that the Academy of Television Arts and Sciences is considering putting the Emmys on HBO,
which has
been winning more of the awards away from the traditional networks lately.
Yeah, right, but let's do the math here. Uh-huh. HBO's winning all the awards.
Right.
ABC, NBC, CBS, Fox, mm-hmm. they're tired of on their networks
losing,
having HBO win.
And paying millions for
so
it.
So they're going to make up their own award.
Yes.
Wouldn't that be cool if the Emmys were on HBO, though, and they all went along with it? Because then people could cuss.
Yeah.
I am super effing happy to win this award.
But then the networks will come up with their own Emmy.
Their own program. Or, in fact, they're talking about counter-programming, putting something entertaining on up against the Emmy, something they've never done before.
Can't we all just get along?
But the HBO Emmys could have nudity.
Hey,
oh, man.
Good idea.
Softcore?
Fantastic.
No, the actual statues would have genitals.
Huge.
HBO's
D's
offering.
And
there you go.
HBO's bidding $7 million higher than the other networks. When Jerry Lewis starts hurting, he reaches for his clicker. And he hates losing his remote even more than you do. Jerry's remote controls the electronic pain-killing device that was implanted in him recently.
Well, it's like Elvis's thing, when Elvis would just hit his button to get his fix.
Only this is electronic as opposed to, being shot up with drugs when you push the button. Now, this device is for the pain that has plagued Jerry for 37 years, since the days of his movie, Pratfalls.
When we press the button, does it let any of the air out of his head?
No, I don't think there's a device for that.
Dino Dean.
The pain led him to an addiction to pain pills, which he eventually beat. But last February, before this implant, Lewis says the pain was so bad, he put a gun in his mouth.
Hey, lady.
Hey, we got the same thing for Jerry Lewis as we have for Bob Hope.
Wow.
Ladies and gentlemen,
I'm putting the gun in my mouth right now, Bert. Well, sorry, I was Bob and then I was Jerry.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's Jerry. Dino Dean.
But Jerry says his daughter walked in on him and told him to use his courage.
Marvelous.
Instead of the gun.
Let me take this marvelous gun out of my mouth.
Look at this. Look at this. It's 38. It's marvelous.
Jerry?
His daughter is like 12.
Yeah.
So she walked in on him?
Yeah.
With a gun in his mouth?
That's right.
Ed was over there. I'll be over here if you need me.
Yeah. And then his daughter like flicked the lighter and it was a big flame.
Hey, lady.
Michael Jackson is being sued for over $20 million for pulling out of two Millennium New Year's Eve concerts.
That's not the only thing he's pulled.
The concert promoter doing
pulled
the suing.
Out many buttocks.
The concert promoter says
tell you that.
Jackson never intended to do the concerts in the first place.
Pulled out of llamas.
And the promoter says he lost hundreds of thousands of dollars on the deal.
Well, he pulls out of his BM on his wet thing.
I didn't feel well. Oh, look at that. Get me a towel.
Jackson's lawyers say Michael only canceled when he realized the shows would not be as profitable as he'd hoped. Michael took the stand in this case this afternoon in Santa Maria, California. He removed his surgical mask before testifying.
Hey, Buzz, hold on. Right. We got a break. We'll be right back.
This
is the Don and Mike Show.
Gosh, I hate to interrupt. It's all been so incredibly fascinating and entertaining and instructive. Really, the time has just flown by.
The Don and Mike Show.
They rock. And that's for Tim, the Don and Mike Show.
Hey, Buzz.
Yeah?
Warning.
What?
Fez is here.
I'm locking the new room door.
Watch out. I just saw Rod and Fez out in the hallway. And I you know, it was nothing said by Fez. But I just know he's on to where you are.
He had lust in his eyes?
You're the ball of yarn. He's the kitty cat.
nobody tell Fezzy that that's the chair that Buzz uses.
Yeah, right.
Because okay. I think Fez thinks that Buzz is in the same room as we are.
Yeah, no. Well, now he'll know. Well, he's been in here and seen Buzz on the
other side. Oh, that's right. I guess he has.
Cover me, okay?
Okay. All right. Anyway.
You know who's the most disappointed about the Olympics being in New York instead of San Francisco 10 years from now?
Who?
Robin Williams.
A-hole.
Who says he was very involved in San Francisco's bid to get the 2012 Games.
I was very involved.
Williams says he was let down when San Francisco was passed over.
And then the Gigi Ferry came. You know what a pompous... I saw him on TV talking about that.
Yeah.
What a pompous ass. You know, well, we in San Francisco, you know, and he was doing his serious... You know, you've got the funny Robin Williams, and I'll give you like a Letterman the other night. He was funny.
Yeah, he killed on Letterman the other
HBO night. HBO special, the last one he did, really funny.
Right.
Then you have the Mrs. Doubtfire Robin Williams.
Yes.
And then you have the one that I hate the most, the Patch Adams Robin Williams.
Right.
And that, he was being Patch Adams when he was doing this patronizing, self-important, over-the-top, but the games could mean so much to all of the San Franciscans.
Do you know he hands out toothbrushes at Halloween every year? And this year, the kids threw the toothbrushes back in his front yard.
Well, you two can go on hating my main man, Robin.
Mike, I just gave him mad props. He said he was funny on Letterman.
All things considered, it was a
and his HBO
a
special.
You know,
his HBO special was very funny.
I understand.
He's just kind of a dick. For this whole bring the Olympics to San Francisco thing.
Bring them to San Francisco and I'll wear crazy socks.
In sports, the NFL says it has no reason to believe that Indianapolis Colts owner Jim Irsay is the target of any investigation. A lawyer for the Colts also says there's no reason to believe that. An Indianapolis TV station says Irsay is being investigated for prescription drug fraud. Irsay has admitted to a past dependency on painkillers because of chronic pain, but the team has denied the TV report.
Anybody in Baltimore tell you he gets it honestly.
And finally, a Holland America cruise ship has been docked in sick bay after 163 passengers fell ill.
Oh, wow.
The Norwalk, based in Port Everglades, Florida, is now being scrubbed to get rid of an intestinal virus.
Yeah.
The virus was...
Welcome to the USS Diarrhea.
Oh, man.
The virus was passed from...
It just doesn't get any better than this.
The virus went from the feces of infected people to food that was then eaten by other people.
Oh, my God.
So they were actually BM eaters.
Yes, they were. Most people recover in 2 to 3 days with no long-term effects.
You.
I'm Buzz Burbank on the Don and Mike Show.
No! No! That is it. We are out of show. See you tomorrow with the American Idiot winner and more. And to our friend Sergeant Lagasse at the Pentagon.
Bill.
Did you read that letter?
I did. Thank you, Sergeant. It means a lot to us, that letter.
We got a real nice letter from the Department of Defense at the Pentagon about the 9/11 show.
Wonderful.
And if we were swinging this, we'd read it on the air. But we're not. But it's just
nice.
It's very nice.
I hope he's listening right now, and I hope he knows how much we appreciate that.
Very
heartfelt. Everybody here, and thanks for mentioning everybody specifically.
We love
that
you
guys. Nice.
Very heartfelt. The only part that I just got to read is that...
Yeah.
It's from the Pentagon now.
Right.
About, they mentioned a lot of radio stations were at the Pentagon on 9/11.
Mm-hmm.
The Don and Mike Show was the only station that kept garish advertising away from their broadcast site.
Wow.
Choosing to show respect.
That's nice.
And, you know,
wonderful.
I know that was a conscious decision on your part not to show the banner.
Other radio stations broadcast to the Pentagon and brought huge banners proclaiming call signs and frequency numbers and hung them on the bleachers used by the attending family and friends of the victims.
That's true.
So anyway, Sarge and everybody at the Pentagon, a great letter. Really, we're going to frame it and hang it on our wall.
Thank you. Send me a bill for the chair.
Thank you. Good day to you,
good
sir.
Good day to you, sir.
Good day to you, sir.
Good day to you, sir.
Can you...
My cook hurts.
BM.
Eaters.
Till we meet again. This is Sammy Davis Jr. saying, be kind, be nice, and I hope the next performer has the pleasure of having as nice an audience as you've been tonight. And let me leave you swinging.